Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee. I am David Torrance, MSP for Kirkcaldy, and as the oldest member of the committee, I have the pleasure of convening this meeting for the first item of business. I have received apologies from Claire Hawkey today, and Tess White will be joining us remotely. Paula Kane, MSP, has now left the committee and has been replaced by Carol Mohun, MSP, and I would like to welcome Carol to the committee. The first item on our agenda is to choose a new deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Labour Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. I invite members of the party to nominate one of their number for this post.
Could I nominate Paul Sweeney, please?
Are members agreed? Can I say congratulations, Paul, and welcome you as deputy convener? And can we suspend the meeting while we change places, please?
Everyone, unfortunately, the convener, Ms. Hawkey, isn't available this morning. She sends her apologies due to illness, so I will be chairing today's meeting. Our next item is a decision on taking business in private, and the committee is proposed to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are we agreed? Okay, thank you. We now move to the next item, which is engagement with NHS boards. The committee will take evidence from Jeff Ace, Chief Executive of NHS Dumfries and Galloway. We will take evidence from Professor Grant Archibald, Chief Executive of NHS Tayside, and also from Professor Jan Gardner, Chief Executive of NHS Lanarkshire. So welcome you all, and thank you for joining us today. So the first kind of area we want to look at, really, is financial sustainability. Clearly, there are significant budgetary pressures across the public sector, and we were wanting to establish some key aspects of that. So, if I may kick off, Audit Scotland's NHS in Scotland 2022 report noted that only 3 of 14 health boards are predicting to break even this financial year, with extensive waiting lists and increases in emergency care among some of the pressures. Could the panel and provide detail on efforts being made by their boards in relation to early intervention to try and prevent the need for emergency care or acute care further down the line, if possible. And perhaps I could start with NHS Lanarkshire, Professor Gardner. Thank you.
Thank you and good morning. So at the end of the financial year 22-23, Lanarkshire is now forecasting to break even, but that's been with significant efforts across the patch. As we go into 23-24, however, a much more challenging position. Our approach to that is fourfold. We are looking to minimise any waste or non-value-added areas within the organisation. We're also looking to optimise performance, looking at upper quartile in other areas, benchmarking to make sure that we are optimising productivity wherever possible. But just those two elements alone, unfortunately, will not bring us to a better sustainable financial position. So in addition to that, we're looking at both service change and radical redesign and reform of our service. In that regard, one of the specific areas that we've been focusing in on because of the challenges that NHS Lanarkshire has been facing is in and around our unscheduled care performance. As colleagues will note, it's been a very, very difficult winter. NHS Lanarkshire and Lanarkshire, the people of Lanarkshire, were hit most significantly by the direct and indirect impact of COVID. And of course, we've seen, unfortunately, the gap in inequalities for health inequalities widen. We're feeling that very acutely at our front doors. And we had a system that was absolutely designed effectively for the healthcare needs in 2019, but we need to acknowledge that those have changed. And the healthcare needs in 2023 are quite significantly different in terms of complex care needs, our population coming forward with frailty issues and broader chronic condition type issues. We've been doing a piece of work that we term Operation Flow. It began at the end of January because of the winter. And the challenges are for our patients, but also for our staff. It was a really, really difficult winter. And so we are very thoughtful as we've gone into this redesign phase that we do not wish to repeat the winter that has been, and we want to take all of the clear learning from that. So the redesign programme of Operation Flow looked at the different elements, how to keep people well at home, how to redirect at the front door appropriately, how to restructure our front door, etc., into our wards, optimising how we flowed through. We undertook a firebreak of 9 days just at the beginning of March, and we saw significant change in our occupancy levels and improvement in our four-hour access. We did that for two reasons, to first of all be comfortable that we were doing the right actions to make that change, and also to lift the spirits of staff who have gone through such a challenging period in time that actually people need confidence and hope that it can look different. We had fantastic impact. Some of our sites dropped from 107% occupancy right down into the 90s, and our four-hour access performance improved, and our waits at 8 hours and 12 hours reduced significantly. However, the challenge is that redesign requires resource and further change. So as we came out of the firebreak, we moved back into challenging performance, but Operation Flow has now kicked off, which is now us looking at this new phase, taking all the learning from that trial period and planning a robust plan for winter 2023-24, and that's where we're at the moment. But it is a whole system effort, and I have to say Lanarkshire works very much as a whole system across health and social care, and indeed with other partners, and indeed the work that we did during Firebreak and Operation Flow 2 is working closely with Scottish Ambulance Service as well.
That's really encouraging. Could I ask if there's been a difference in the ability to do three-year financial planning? Has that made an impact in your ability to be more sustained in your approach?
Yeah, so it certainly will allow us, because we will need to shape change. There are some reform, and it means that we will need to change where we have some of our investment to bolster that front end of the hospital and to get people back in their own homes and as quickly and as effectively as we possibly can. To do that across 1 year is incredibly challenging, but across three does give us further flexibility. However, the challenge, and we're working with Scottish Government colleagues in and around our plan at the moment, is whether we will be able to undertake that full redesign and indeed reform and look at how we have sustainable services across our three acute sites within that three-year period. But that's the aspiration that we work towards, is to use the flexibility most effectively.
Okay. And what impact has the recent inflationary pressure had on your cost base, and also perhaps on capital investments? We know there's been particular issues around repair backlogs across several evidence sessions we've had with NHS boards so far. So whilst there's an issue of operational flow, maintaining efficiencies, the three-year financial envelope, what impact has this increase in inflation had on your ability to plan for a break-even point?
So the impact in 2022-23 was really significant around our energy costs. We estimated, based up to the end of the calendar year, that was up to as much as 59% in terms of some of our additional energy costs, which were very, very challenging this year. Although we're hoping that will be significantly lower, at the moment estimating 14.5-15% for this financial year coming, we still are concerned, obviously, about the impact. We have done a huge amount of work to make our buildings more sustainable, and in Lanarkshire we have three PFI buildings. However, as colleagues may also be aware, the University Hospital Monkland site does have significant repair issues that have also been in media recently, and we are continuing to work through those. Those are our most significant pressure area in terms of our main maintenance because the PFI contracts make it a slightly different way of managing some of our capital in terms of maintenance. But on the Wishaw site, unfortunately, the Monkland site, we still have ongoing challenges in and around some of the repairs, and that's an ongoing issue that we are looking also about a potential Monkland replacement project at the same time.
And is that Monkland's replacement project still on track, or is there any challenges around procuring that because of the increase in construction inflation?
So there has been some increases, as you'd expect, but in terms of our case that has gone forward, it also includes all of those costs, and that decision has gone forward into the executive with Scottish Government, and we are awaiting a decision on that at the moment.
Okay, thanks very much. Professor Archibald, I would just like to invite you to maybe address us on the points made by your colleague from NHS Lanarkshire around that need for flow, financial sustainability, and particularly the idea of you've been able to introduce measures to prevent people presenting to acute services, where you can address issues perhaps further down the chain of the patient journey to avoid cost later on.
Thank you very much, Chair, and good morning, colleagues. Yes, reflecting on what Jan said, I think you referenced the Audit Scotland report, Chair, and that identifies that this isn't an NHS issue, it isn't a Scotland issue. There are global challenges emerging from the post-COVID environment, and a lot of those are related to very high inflation rates, ones that we haven't seen maybe from the 70s, and also increasing energy costs. And anyone that's been in any hospital facility will know the high demand on energy that we place. You referenced performance, Chair, and if I might, our unscheduled care performance and the data that's going to be reported today in Tayside is going to be 94.9%. We have no 12-hour breachers, we have no 8-hour breachers in the last week. Our unscheduled care system is recognised as the best performing in mainland UK, and we're regularly in the high 80s and the low 90s. And as Jan reflected, that's a whole system approach, and you talked about the management of demand and the management of the presentations, and I think that's a key element. And I think we should reflect that that's a product of GPs, that's a product of good primary care services, that's a product of good relationships, and it's a product of good working inside hospitals. And we have invested considerably in that over the last decade, and it continues to pay results. In terms of the diversion of activity or managing it in the best place would probably be better to reference. We established a flow navigation centre, as was required by government, but we put senior clinicians in the front line in that service, so we put consultants in it. And if I might give you just some figures, we routinely see 1,600 ED attenders across NHS Tayside in a week. Our flow navigation centre is now dealing with 700 contacts in a week. A third of those come to hospital immediately. A third of those are identified to come at a convenient time for both the patient and ourselves, so out with a busy time, and a third are diverted to other services. And that also includes direct contact between our consultants and ambulances on the road to make sure patients are taken to the right place. And that's what we need to remember in all this, I would suggest. This is about people and about how they work together. It's about relationships and it's about understanding. And I think that's been key to all of our designs. Hugely impressed by my clinical team in that they come up with ideas for driving services forward, and not only in unscheduled care, but we've continued to outperform the Scottish metrics since the former Cabinet Secretary's announcement last July in terms of our improvement in long waiters on our waiting lists, both for outpatients and inpatients and day cases. We outperform the Scottish average on our cancer services as well. And the whole point of that is seeing it as a whole system. And that has involved redesign already. So we've gone from cataracts doing about 12 to 14 in a day session to our consultants coming forward with ideas about how that might be improved. We now do 50 in a day. And that has led to a great improvement in our ophthalmology waiting times. But it also makes us the third most productive unit in the UK. So there are examples where clear actions are taken that benefit results straight away for patients, but also identify productivity. Given the financial challenges we face, the least we should be aiming for is upper quartile, upper quintile performance to be efficient as we can be. But my final comment would be I'm interested in population health and prevention. I've worked in the NHS in Scotland for 40 years, and we are still seeing a 10-year gap between life expectancy amongst those most in need in terms of financial services and those that are most wealthy. And indeed, there are parts of a recent report that say the healthy life years between those in the lowest economic group and the highest, it can be 26 healthy years. Mm. And so the challenge for ourselves, and I'm doing it with my colleagues in Tayside, who are fantastically supportive, in Dundee, in Angus and Perth councils, we're all working together to try to find out ways as the key stakeholders in our Tayside, as the biggest employers in Tayside, what can we be doing to ensure that people don't fall into ill health, but we prevent ill health and we promote a health service and not an ill health service. Mm. And perhaps through the day we'll pick up different examples of that.
Thank you very much. Dr. Kahane, you had a supplementary.
Thank you. Before I ask my question, I'd like to draw people to my register of interest as an NHS GP who's worked recently within the NHS Dumfries and Galloway and NHS Lanarkshire board areas. Professor Archibald, you talked about your figures, but you implement a continuous flow model. And so that means patients moving out of A&E, whether a bed is available for them or not. And so potentially they would sit in a corridor, they would sit in a side room or a waiting room, or they might sit within a ward environment as an extra. So where would those patients be captured in the data?
Patients are captured in the data. If there's anyone that's required to be moved out of ED, they're still on the clock. And we've had our services audited, and we've also had visits from government to see the systems that we're working. Be very pleased to invite you to come and attend and say that as well, because that is a commentary that's often offered about ourselves. I can say this, my office looks out over A&E and I don't see queues of ambulances. And that's a first indicator that a system's under pressure. We do not have that. And so perhaps it would be useful for us to share more detail with you. But I can assure you that the processes that are reflected in Tayside are a process in working order. And I'm happy and content for people to come and see it.
Thank you. Just wanted to turn to Mr. Ace, NHS Dumfries and Galloway. Obviously, we mentioned about patient flow, the need for cost avoidance where possible to try and address the financial sustainability of health boards. Just wonder if you could perhaps introduce some of the things you're doing in NHS Dumfries and Galloway, mindful of what colleagues have already said.
Yes, and I'll avoid repetition, Chair. We're all engaged in the sorts of redesigns that you would expect us to be, and we're all engaged in the sort of best value work that you would expect us to be to reduce waste, to try and improve efficiency and performance. I think it is important to note, though, that this is not a usual financial position for the NHS in Scotland. This is not part of our usual times are difficult financial pressures. We'll run a deficit for 22-23 in Dumfries and Galloway for the first time this century. Looking ahead, the scale of the gap that you can project using the inflationary pressures, using our requirements to achieve activity goals, is probably beyond our usual levels of efficiency savings. We've set ourselves a target of achieving 3% per year, which is right up there at the historic high levels that the system has ever achieved. And that's not enough. It doesn't bridge the gap. Indeed, the gap continues to grow. And whilst we're probably at the top end of Scotland's financial problems proportionately, I think all boards are reporting real difficulties with achieving that break even as you project through that 2-3 year forecast. That's not how Scotland has been over the past decade. It's been difficult, but it's not been as it is now and as it appears that it is going to be. So this is going to require a level of service redesign and real difficult decisions that I think we've not seen in the period preceding this. And I think for individual boards, particularly relatively small boards like myself, we're going to have to collaborate regionally to a level of engagement that we've not managed before. And we're going to have to collaborate nationally so that we have a Once for Scotland programme that really brings those sort of plans together. Because I think the scale of the gap now, if I was to turn it into workforce, I technically can't afford 1 in 10 of my workforce. But clearly, I need all of those people and more to deliver the service demands that we're facing. So the financial challenge, I would want committee members to be aware, is quite extraordinary at the moment. Like Grant, I've worked in the NHS since the 80s. I'm a finance director by background. I have never seen a position as challenging as this, and it will require all of us from a national perspective, a regional perspective, and local boards to be focused on that redesign to give us a chance of getting through this.
Ms. Harper, you had a supplementary.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. I'm going to ask Jeff Asa a particular question, but before I ask my question, I need to remind everybody I'm a former NHS Dumfries and Galloway employee, and I was part of the COVID vaccine team as a nurse during the pandemic, so I just wanted to make sure I'm clear about that. I wanted to ask you, Mr. Ace, what particular changes have been made for service delivery? I know we met last Friday as part of our normal updates, and parts of Dumfries and Galloway are really remote and rural, and so one of the things that you talked about was the development of home teams. Is that something that will help, I suppose, manage the service in a better way in order to help look at not necessarily savings, but just efficiency?
Yes, hopefully both. I mean, hopefully a much better service for the local population and a more efficient one in terms of use of resources as well. I think a number of boards will be able to talk to you about hospital at home type models. As you say, with our very dispersed population, our rural population, we've actually looked at 8 local teams across the Dumfries and Galloway, trying to base those around GP clusters so that we get our primary care teams right at the core of this, linking in then with community nursing, district nursing, trying to avoid hospital admissions and working closely with local care homes in that to allow flexibility in our bed-based use. So trying to avoid hospital admissions wherever appropriate. And then when an individual is admitted either to the Galloway Community Hospital or to DGRI or to Mid Park, we allow as fast as possible repatriation of that individual to a facility close to their home, or indeed we support them back to their home. So it's really early days, as you're aware, in this project. But initially, it seems both popular with patients. It seems to be a good environment for our staff to work in. We're getting very positive reports back. I think good engagement from primary care, and it is delivering that efficiency of model that we need to see. So again, I don't wish to be gloomy in front of the committee, but I would like to say the efficiencies that we can talk about here are absolutely what the systems constantly need to be aiming at, but they're not of the scale at the moment to address the financial deficit. And that's the one that's probably causing the sleepless nights at the moment, is just that scale of cost reduction that we're faced with. So yes, home teams for us is something that we're throwing an awful lot of management resource and time around to get right, because we think it's the right thing to do and it's the right model for our dispersed community. It will improve efficiency, it will save a little bit of money, but it's not of the scale to address the problem that we see financially.
Can you, you raised a major point there about 1 in 10 of your payroll not being affordable. And you mentioned also that the financial efficiencies that you're hoping to achieve will come nowhere near to addressing, even in under a 3-year planning window, the backlog. So what is it that is needed to make you not have sleepless nights?
I think, as I've said, what we need to see is a coordination across Scotland of service plans, workforce plans, and financial plans that work at a national and a regional and a local level that deliver that service that's fit for the future. We've all got good examples locally of change that can be made, that can improve service and can reduce cost. We've now got to implement those sort of changes at real scale. I think we've been, during the pandemic years, we've really not had that capacity to look at our models and to say what's going to work for our demographic challenges of the next 20 years. There was a fantastic piece of work that came out a week or so ago by Professor Roy, looking at Scotland's demographics over the next generation and beyond, right up into the 2070s, showing that significant increase in the number of older adults in Scotland and a significant reduction in the working age population of Scotland. That creates a sort of existential challenge to our current service models. And we've got to be similarly radical in our reshaping of those models locally, regionally and nationally to meet those challenges. Otherwise, I fear that the scale of the gap, the financial challenge, will force us into the sort of service cuts and reductions that none of us want to see. So it's up to us at this moment to be very bold, I think, in our models for what we see as being the right health and care service for Scotland at that regional, national and local level, and to start engaging with our population about those big changes that are needed.
Ms Harper, you want to come back in? Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks again, Convener. Just to come back, Jeff, on what you said about Scotland-wide approach for, I suppose, combined or joined services. Do you mean combined as in combining human resources as part of joint work and integration, or combined financial services? So that means, like, if NHS and Fraser and Galloway is a small board, is that something that could work, looking at that, or does that need to be a more wider Scotland approach as well?
I think both. I think both consideration of joint services, and that can be clinical and non-clinical, and also looking at integrated patient pathways. We've also got huge opportunities with the changes of technology now. As you know, for example, if I look at imaging, and I chair the National Diagnostic Board, we can now set up systems where a radiologist in one board can report on the scans from another board. So we can save huge amounts of resources by pooling demand and addressing that to the right capacity, rather than individual boards not being able to report scans and having to go to, for example, to private sector to report that overload. So there are things that are moving technologically that allow us work together to collaborate much more effectively than we have in the past. I think imaging is a very obvious one. I think laboratory services is another, where in Scotland we can be quite bold and look at what is required over the next generation for a population of 5.2, 5.3 million. What is the best possible laboratory service that we can provide for that population, and how can we configure that in the most effective way? I think those are the big sort of questions that we now have to ask and answer in the light of this, in the context of this financial problem. Now, none of that is saying this will be a worse service at the end of that. I think we've got huge opportunities to catch up on the change that perhaps we haven't made during the pandemic years, and to create a much more modern, fit for future service. But it does require us to think on that national and regional scale, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Evelyn Tweed, you wanted to come in on some areas of performance. I think that leads us neatly into this issue.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. And my first question is to Professor Archibald. I'm really interested in your A&E figures, 91%, which is fantastic. Can you share with us how that works? I know that Sandesh had asked a question earlier. And are you sharing your learning with other boards?
Thank you very much indeed. As I try to explain it, this is a product of keeping a system in harmony and being able to ensure that the flows continue to work. So part of the question about flows is about delayed discharges, and we've achieved significant improvements in those recently. But having worked in other boards in Scotland, the level of delayed discharges in Tayside is significantly lower. Again, that's good cooperation between ourselves and our IJB colleagues, and believe that the Angus IJB is probably the best performing one in the whole of Scotland. Last week we had one patient in from Angus, which is a reasonable population. the whole design of this has been formulated by the clinicians themselves, and I think that's key. And I've run ED departments in Glasgow, in Edinburgh, in Lanarkshire, and in Fife. And so I have seen other parts of the system. And the thing that impresses me most about Tayside is that the clinicians have engaged in a long time with a very clear view about what they're trying to do. And we, myself, but indeed previous people, have tried to make sure that we support them in their endeavours. I think the Flow Navigation Centre is a great example of that, because that's creative thinking. And if all 700 of those patients were to turn up at the door of my hospitals this week, then that would mean my attendances went from 1,600 to 2,300, and that would be unsustainable in hospital terms. So it is about thinking clearly about that. We have an expert frailty model that tries to deal with frail elderly patients that are coming in. So there are all several examples, and we have a command centre. Jan and her colleagues have been to see it from Lanarkshire. We've had Ayrshire and Arran with us. Grampian have been in contact with us. Two of our colleagues went through to work with colleagues in Glasgow. We're not saying that everything we do is an immediate fit for elsewhere, but as I said to your colleague, I'm more than happy that people come and see what we're doing, because I'm immensely proud of the efforts that are put in. And given the challenges that have been seen across not only Scotland, but England, Northern Ireland and Wales, to be regularly achieving the performance level we have are quite remarkable. In one of the periods, I think we saw 12-hour breachers in a period from January to April this year. Scotland had 19,000. So we are different, and we are working to continue that. As I say, it's a product of collaborative working, but there are systems as well that colleagues have come to see, and we're very pleased to try and share that learning. I've said in Tayside that we don't need to be the first to do things, but we need to try to be the best, and if that means learning from others, and I've reached out to other boards where they're good at things, to be supported by them.
Thanks, Professor Archibald. I think that's a great offer. It's certainly one that I would like to take up, and I think maybe the committee will chat about that after the session. My second question is to Professor Gardner. Can you tell us more about the fire break? How did that work? And also, were there any negative impacts from the fire break?
Yeah, so thanks very much. And it leads on actually very, very nicely from Grant's comment. In terms of the run-up to the fire break, we took time to really design what we were going to do and to bring our staff with us on board. Similarly, it's our clinicians who have done the fantastic work. They are the people who drive the service and who have the ideas. However, we wanted to also help them, I touched on that before, have hope and to look at the future in terms of how we could do things differently. So we did different site visits because we are all very open to learning, and Grant and his team were fantastic and supportive at helping us evolve our plans. So the first part prior to fire break was designing what we were going to do. The second part then was in the fire break. We noticed a period where we took resource from different parts of our system to effectively create the model of care that we wanted to create and we would like to create going forward. And as we enter into, we've just literally yesterday launched Operation Flow 2, we'll now embed some of that change. So it is full system. It's taking all the different learning and the elements that have been talked about are a decade in the laying down of a structure. And the resource piece is really, really important for us. And we recognise that we need to resource it in a different way. And we need to redesign some of the distribution of our resources to be able to effectively run a service in the way that Tayside and others have done. We've been to Glasgow and seen some of the flow model that your colleague spoke about as well, similarly in Tayside model. But it is that whole flow. It has to be at the back end of the hospital. So we have to make sure our delayed discharges, so in partnership working, we worked really cohesively with our health and social care partnerships to look and to do a really active view. But it starts at the beginning. So it's each different part of the pathway. It starts before somebody comes into hospital. We looked at different ways of supporting. So if I give a few examples, in care homes where perhaps patients might have been brought to hospital. We similarly augmented our flow navigation to be able to give advice to people who had elderly patients in care homes rather than bringing the patients into the hospital. Through the fire break, we doubled the number of hospital at home beds, virtual beds that we had, and augmented some of the care of the elderly and the advanced nurse practitioner roles in that space. So we were looking, first of all, for opportunities to keep people well. In our flow navigation and taking some of the learning from Tayside and other areas, we then worked with our Scottish Ambulance colleagues to do professional-to-professional calls, so to try to give advice to a range of professionals in our community and in the ambulance service to give advice at the right place at the right time to avoid, again, the conveyance of an ambulance. Then coming into the A&E, for those patients who arrived in the A&E, what we were trying to achieve was a flow in that department. We know, unfortunately, as bed weights become a problem, then the departments become clogged. And the worst challenge that we see, and that has a terrible impact on staff morale and patient experience, is when effectively you have a full A&E and then our staff are trying to manage effectively that flow almost at the same time in parallel. So we were working hard in our ward area to make sure that every day, every single person understood their role. And that's the big communication piece that we were doing in the run-up to the fire break. And that's where people are really keen to get back to. So every single ward had a ward beat, a discharge rate that they were trying to work to. They did board rounds to, again, constantly be focusing on what every patient needed and what was the most efficient pathway for them. Working in partnership, I can't overstress the fact this has to be everyone with skin in the game in terms of every part of the system working cohesively. And we saw that because everybody was able to free up enough resource. It's not enormous changes, but we look at it like a jigsaw puzzle. We have a lot of the fantastic pieces. We've got brilliant people, great clinicians working really, really hard, but we've got some of our jigsaw pieces missing. During fire break, we tried to put those right pieces in place to augment and give a more cohesive picture. It made our wards work more effectively, so we had better flow, reduced length of stay. We started, although not statistically significant because the period wasn't long enough, we started to see a reduction in length of stay. We started to see a reduction in onward care needs, and so therefore, again, less of an impact on discharge care needs, etc. And we started to see a difference in experience for our patients and indeed for our clinicians able to deal with patients. You asked though about the adverse impact. I would have to say the hardest part of it was that we knew we couldn't sustain, and that people went into it knowing that it was to test a new model for us and then to confidently build, because it is a significant resource shift that we will need to make. And so to make sure that we were clear on the return on investment of every single piece of those jigsaw pieces. And so that's the piece that's come out. It's been hard for staff because actually their heads were lifted. People started to work in the way that they want to work. Our clinicians felt assured. And in terms of all the work that we've all been doing in health and wellbeing for our staff, the best thing that you can do for somebody is to be able to come to work in the right environment in the right way and to provide the care. And the distress for everybody of working in the wrong way has been very, very significant. So the hard part is that we have dipped, but the spirits are high and people have the ambition to get back there right now. And so the commitment, though, has to be that we do that now and we build in time for winter.
Thank you. Convener, could I have one more?
Certainly.
Thanks. My last question is to Jeff Ace. Jeff, I'm a former resident of Dumfries and Galloway, stayed down there for 16 years, and one statistic jumped out of your submission, that senior managers' turnover is 33.3% in 22-23. Can you talk us through that, Jeff?
We have such a tiny cohort of senior managers that a few retirements really generated that figure could be naught in some years, but it's purely driven by a small number of retirals.
Okay, so there's no issues with culture or leadership or any issues of that nature?
I would hesitate to say there are no issues with culture in any organisation, I think, and we should always be looking to challenge ourselves. But in these particular cases, I know the reasons for retirals of these individuals. So, no, that wasn't a driver. But all organisations, particularly coming out of the last 3 years, need to be very aware of pressure on staff, including managerial staff, and how we regenerate the sort of optimism that Jan was talking about a minute ago, and trying to get that belief that teams can make things better. I think that's a challenge for all of us at the moment. The staff, you'll have heard before, this sense that staff are tired after the pandemic, that this has felt like a long slog without much light at the end of the tunnel. I think it's our job as leaders to really to try and re-inject that optimism and give staff the sort of plan that Jan was talking about there. This is how we can make things better. This is how we can make it feel better to work in this environment. This is how we can improve patient outcomes and patient experience. That return of optimism after the last 3 years, I think, is a critical thing that we as leaders need to be focused on.
Just before we move on, I wanted to ask a quick question to Professor Nagarden about particularly A&E performance in Lanarkshire. It was at 60% from the chart I saw. Just wondering if you could account for that particularly low level relative to other areas of Scotland.
Yes, thank you very much. So as colleagues will be aware, in NHS Lanarkshire we have 3 acute hospitals, and actually that in itself is both an opportunity and a challenge in terms of workforce sustainability and providing those 3 services. Across our 3 hospitals, we have very different challenges and indeed opportunities, and we've seen quite a variation in the performance across the 3 different hospitals. The work that I've been speaking about, without going back into all the detail of that, is quite targeted on what each of those 3 sites need. So if I raise particularly the point around, for example, University Hospital Wishaw, which has had particular challenges through the winter, the configuration on that site is slightly different. It also deals as a Lanarkshire trauma centre. It also has our paediatric neonates and obstetrics area coming in through that door. And the flow from the population that is served and its location very close to the very centre of Wishaw also means that you have a different flow in. We are looking through this work that we're doing to understand again how we rebalance across our 3 hospitals and how we raise the challenge. Right now, though, our issues are, again, back to that whole system. I'm sorry, kind of coming back to the same point. It's not about our A&E as a challenge. It is about that full system. Our wards, our length of stay has drifted back up. Our delayed discharges were working very well, and actually they are in a positive place, although we are working to reduce them further. But it is every single part of the system, and it's finding that jigsaw puzzle, getting that perfect picture. Why are we in a more challenging position than Scotland? I think a lot of that is linked to our demographics and the system that we have at the moment, which isn't effectively designed to deliver against that demographic. And I think the direct and indirect issues post-pandemic are having certainly a significant issue with frailty, with chronic conditions, and the throughput of patients with the most complex conditions is a significant issue for us.
Thanks very much. Just going to bring in Emma Harper now on COVID recovery.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks very much again, convener. So I'm interested in the COVID recovery. So the Scottish Government published a COVID recovery document August 21, and I'm interested to know how that is working out for the different boards, and if there's anything in it that you would change after implementing some of the recommendations as part of COVID recovery. Don't know who wants to go first.
I'll take that if you don't mind.
Set your microphone, so don't need to press the button, don't worry.
Sorry, thank you. Thank you very much for the question. Yes, some reflections then from Tayside, and then a broader comment. In terms of Tayside ourselves, we have Strathcathro Hospital, we have Perth Royal Infirmary, and we have Nine Wells, which is our major hospital. And throughout the pandemic period, as compared to other places, we didn't ever
suspend all elective surgery. We tried to keep some sites running and continue to deliver services. And that's evidenced by the Scottish data about the management of waiting lists and the relative growth of our waiting lists compared to the All Scotland position. But in terms of the recovery plan, which has been key for us all, we're looking to recover not to 2019, but to what's required in 2023 and beyond. But we did have targets, and therefore I'm pleased to advise that in the recently issued Scottish data, not my own data, the recently issued Scottish data, Tayside is at 99% of its pre-COVID position in terms of inpatients and day cases, and it is at 96% in terms of its outpatients. And at each stage in the recovery plan, Chair, we have overperformed against the trajectory that we had agreed with government. I think the key challenge is that's the now, but as Jeff and others have reflected, the next looks quite different from the pre-COVID period. And I think it's really important that we remain versatile and adaptive and understand where our pressures are. I should, as I say, much prefer that we could put more time into prevention rather than ill health services, but there are already a backlog of people who need care, so that's going to be something Scotland's going to have to manage over the next few years. In terms of the recovery plan itself, I think it's very important for us all to give hope not only to the patients who may be waiting for services such as surgery, elective surgery, but also to our staff that it's going to be better and different, and it's not going to continue to be the same as it is now. And that's part of our redesign elements with all our clinical teams in terms of how do we build not back to 2019 now, but to something different and better and more appropriate for the demands we're seeing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I may add, in terms of the Lanarkshire work, again, planned and unplanned care goes hand in glove. And so the challenge for us has been, again, ensuring that we have sufficient beds to be able to bring in elective patients when we have unscheduled care pressures. However, Lanarkshire is working very diligently to redesign and to find new ways of working in terms of addressing the plans that were set out. We are currently sitting in, across a variety of specialties from 70 to 90% of pre-pandemic levels. We also have an additional challenge for us in that Lanarkshire uses the Golden Jubilee Hospital as part of that elective plan, and for the obvious and right needs of Scotland, some of those allocations have changed to give to the patients who need it most, and that means that we have lost some of our pre-pandemic capacity that we would have had, which again has been a challenge. So we're looking at different ways of redesigning how we deliver service. We're also embracing the use of technology with things such as colon capsule and cytosponge, offering different ways of being able to give people access to diagnostics in that space as well, and continue to redesign to work differently at the same time. But it is a whole system. It keeps coming back to the whole system in terms of the balance. We are all absolutely focused in bringing our unscheduled care performance up, bringing our planned care back. But I think the point that a number of us have made, it is the recalibration to what is right in 2023. We're also working with the new National Elective Coordination Unit, again, that is a national piece, to try to look at the waiting list that we have and to make sure that those who are waiting are still in need of the same thing, and that also while they wait, they are well supported. So we are trying different ways to support as we bring our performance back.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And just before Jeff comes in, the recovery plan is a 5-year plan, so it's not an overnight fix to come out of COVID. I think that's something that it's going to take time, and I know that as a nurse myself. I'm interested in the cancer diagnostic centres. I know one was created in Ayrshire, one in Fife and one in Dumfries and Galloway, and I know part of the prevention and early diagnostics, that's something I think is happening in NHS Dumfries and Galloway, as far as well as self-sampling for cervical cancer diagnosis. There's a trial going on there. I don't know if that's something that Mr. Ace would like to comment on.
Yes, thanks for making Fina. I think the early diagnostic centres work in Scotland, as you say, we set up three initial pilots. We're now at five boards that have the early diagnostics route. It is really, really promising in what it's delivering. As you know, Scotland, like much of the UK, has a relatively poor record compared to international best practice in terms of the early diagnosis and treatment of cancer. But what the pilots are showing is that we can identify, if we work in partnership with GP colleagues, giving a really rapid access to diagnostic expertise, multidisciplinary review, we can identify some of those previously difficult cancers that aren't presenting with absolutely standard markers that make diagnosis easy. We can get to some of those more difficult cancers earlier. And I think all three of the original pilot sites are reporting very positively in terms of what can be done with fairly small resource, really. It's more of an organisational, reorganisational issue. So I'm very pleased with that, both locally and as I'm part of the National Working Group on that as well. In terms of the broader catch-up with our pre-pandemic performance, I think it's important to stress, as Grant said, all of our systems are working to get back to their pre-pandemic activity levels, and that is a challenge. We found it particularly difficult in terms of major elective surgery, so elective surgery that requires several days post-operative length of stay, because we found it difficult to guarantee those beds because of the pressure on unscheduled care. I don't have an elective centre locally, so DGRI has to operate both as a hot and a cold site, and it's been hard to ring fence that cold capacity for major surgical work, so that's a challenge. But I would also point out that just getting back to our pre-pandemic levels is not going to fix the backlog. It will simply stop things getting worse. What we need to do then is to overachieve activity for several years, as you've pointed out, in order to catch up with that huge lost work during the pandemic period. So yes, 5 years is itself ambitious. It will certainly take us a period of time to create that catch up. And if I think back to the early mid 2000s, where we really radically reduced waiting times, and we made enormous strides in cutting waits from years to weeks. That came with huge amounts of resources, huge amounts of extra staffing, none of which are likely to be on the table given the context that we've talked about earlier. So this is a massive redesign challenge for Scotland that we will throw ourselves into, and we will absolutely continue to make the gains that we're making, but the challenge is very significant over the next few years.
Yep, very quickly.
Thanks. Just to come back quickly, it was what Professor Archibald said about prevention and keeping folk out of hospital. So, you know, I'm the cross-party group convener of the Lung Health Cross-Party Group, and we talk about keeping people with COPD fit and healthy and out of hospital, same with asthma as well. Is that some of the work that you're undertaking as well?
Yes, absolutely. I think there are two elements of prevention in my mind. There's the immediate prevention, your good example of managing people with COPD. Some of us are old enough to remember you used to come in and be in for 4 days to get your tonsils out. We now have people at Strathclyde walking out on the same day as they've had their hip or their knee replaced. So the world has moved on, yet the demand is still there. So my two points would be, who can be managed at home through frailty units and support? Exactly so. But I think there's a bigger question about how do we manage demand? How do we get out into communities? We can identify the communities that are going to have particular issues in their health over the next few years. And I think my wish, my ambition in Tayside is to engage more and put more of our effort into that to make sure that we are able to deal with the levels of demand that might present in the next 3 to 5 years. People think of public health and population health as something that pays back over decades. Sometimes it can pay back quickly if you focus it. And the example I would quote is, in Dundee, we eradicated Hep C amongst the drug-using population within 3 years, 13 years ahead of the WHO international standard. So I've studied public health. and therefore I know that there are issues about eons and taking a long time to deal with things. But the Origin of Public Health was identifying a dirty standpipe poisoning the population in Victorian London, and they fixed the standpipe. And my last point about that would be the analogy I've used when I'm speaking to my colleagues, and I hope it will be helpful in this meeting. I'm young enough to remember that the firemen used to run around and lights were always blazing, they were going up and down ladders. Now 80% of firemen's time is in prevention. They put in smoke detectors. What are the smoke detectors in health? Because we can't keep developing acute and emergency services, given the staffing challenges we're going to have over the next few years, and also given the financial challenges we face. I hope that was a helpful analogy, Chair.
Would you like to come in and further these points?
Yeah. Thanks, Convener. On the progress of the recovery plan in particular, are there any particular areas the witnesses would highlight where good progress has been made, and why do you think that this is? I'll maybe go to Professor Gardner first.
Yeah, thank you. And I think I would want to just first of all talk about what good is. And actually, I think that's a challenge for us, because I think we're very often drawn to the numbers, and actually some of these good innovative examples of care are also good, and it's trying to keep that balance whilst we also keep the eye on performance. And maybe linking back to that last point, Lanarkshire again is also about to have one of the early diagnostic centres for cancer, but actually we've been doing a lot of really good innovative work in and around cancer as a challenge. One of the elements we're seeing coming out of COVID is the fact that we are having a higher number of patients presenting with these early symptoms, although actually the conversion rate to confirmed diagnosis actually isn't the same as it would have been pre-COVID. So although the numbers are higher, actually, fortunately, the numbers actually with a positive cancer diagnosis isn't in direct correlation. But we're doing work with using video technology and telehealth to do active referral triage early doors. So that means that people are being seen, or indeed their case has been considered early by senior clinicians, because again, it's giving that peace of mind, it's giving the right focused approach, and that's really important so we don't waste resource in this time. We also have the discharge patient initiated reviews. So rather than giving people lots and lots of repeat appointments and return appointments, when patients themselves are concerned, there's ways of coming back into their service. I also touched on things such as the colon capsule, cytosponge, but we're also using things like double QFIT testing to help to look at the patients who are most likely to be in need of our help. Also, I think what is a really significant part of this next part of health is about pathway redesign, keeping people well, looking at using advanced practice where we can, giving patients access when they know they need the help, and that's what we're trying to do. And in things such as low-risk lung pathway that we're looking at as an example in Lanarkshire, again, advanced practice nurses being able to help patients to see somebody when they need it most. It's also really important that we do continue to work with national services such as the National Elective Coordination Unit, where across Scotland we can pull on the resources that are there to again help our patients to be triaged. So those are just examples of where we are beginning to reform. It's not how we used to do things, but it is us trying to look at our workforce, our technology, and to try to harness those into our services. Thank you.
Any other further points?
Yeah, if I might, our approach has been twofold. One has been about demand management, and in its real sense. So in that respect, we put in a review of patient-initiated returns, which was, rather than having new-to-return ratios dictated by ourselves, how could we get patients to indicate by a call whether they felt they needed to come back or not? That freed up greater than 5,000 appointments. So I think that's a huge achievement. And then again, in terms of our active clinical referral programme, we went through that and we were able to identify another 12,000, greater than 12,000 appointments that could be used. So I think it's very important in all that we do that we engage with our communities. Jan identified the cancer example, and that's important because if we got a lot of people, in inverted commas, the worried well being referred in, then it will block up diagnostics and it will slow down the level of capacity available for those that actually are identified with cancer. So that's why demand management and our engagement with our population, our GPs, clear referral guidelines and constant dialogue is very important. And then there's clearly the issue about delivery and productivity. So I've already referenced the huge jump in productivity we've achieved clinician-led in our ophthalmology service. We have the best performing single robot site in Scotland. And one of my challenges, Jan mentioned Monklands, one of my challenges in Tayside, 53% of my real estate is over 50 years old. And Nine Wells is 50 years old this year, and it's my major hospital. Now, I've been lucky enough to work at Edinburgh Royal Infirmary. I opened Wishaw General. I opened Queen Elizabeth in Glasgow. And new hospitals don't guarantee better care, but they give you a better chance of delivering it. And I think that there is something about infrastructure we need to look at as well. And then finally, in terms of our key productivity metrics, we're looking at how do we become more adaptable to our population needs and providing services at times that are most convenient and going to be used. And that's about embracing issues such as DNAs, but also looking at productivity of theatres and setting ourselves the most challenging standard. I said before to the committee, we do need to be upper quintile in order to be able to identify ourselves as a high-performing organisation. We then can have a debate about the challenges of resourcing going forward, as referenced in the Auditor General's report.
That's great, thank you. I was wondering if we could go to Jeff as well.
Yes, thanks. I think certainly in terms of the surgical productivity examples that have been given, we can list our own, and we're... very recently, we undertook, for example, our first four joint list. Now, I know for some of the elective centres, that's pretty old hat, but for us as a small DGH, that was quite a milestone for us to get through. We've just redesigned our own ophthalmic theatres here to allow a significant increase in our productivity. And I think, as Grant said, boards will need to be challenged on that level of productivity improvement as we're going forward. I don't think we have a luxury in Scotland of allowing a significant variation in productivity. And if a board like myself can't be as productive as somewhere elsewhere, then my whole service model needs to be questioned, and I need to be put under pressure to increase my productivity. So I think we in Scotland need to give that absolute guarantee as individual boards that we are exploring the real leading edge, efficiency, productivity, flow redesign, etc. The bigger issue, I think, is around that population health, is about how do we work with our population to give them the health that allows our services to cope, if you like. And this feels like a huge challenge. And yet we have sections of our population who are already at that health. Our most affluent population at the moment are not using our services to the extent of our least affluent. And that's not some sort of historic accident, that they are able to benefit from choices, from their own experiences, their access to leisure, etc., that puts them in a health position that's markedly different from those without those choices. So as Grant says, we can focus our public health activity and our health improvement activity on those where there is the most massive difference and a rapid difference, to take pressure off services, but also to do ethically the right thing. That it is completely unacceptable in the 21st century to have the sort of gap between healthy expected life years that we have between our least and our most affluent. So there's a moral imperative for us to do the right thing here that will also take enormous pressure off our services. And we've seen from work such as the Newcastle Life Curve about how to enable healthy aging, that you can make absolutely dramatic changes to people's frailty and to their absence of dependence on services. And that has to be a huge part of how Scotland recovers from COVID and delivers a health and care service that's sustainable, high performing, and meets the needs of those that most need it. So it's one of those beautiful occurrences, I think, where the right thing comes together with what we need to do. And sets that agenda for us over the next decade.
That's great, thanks. And that very neatly leads me onto my second question. Now, agree with the whole panel that we do need to start looking at how we improve population health as a whole in order to not just make the NHS more sustainable, but to give people better quality of life as well. Does the panel believe that the NHS recovery plan that we have now can actually act as a catalyst to change some of the way we're doing things and move more attention towards that preventative health agenda? Or are we just at risk of focusing on the acute pathways and repeating the mistakes of old, of not moving quickly enough? Professor Gardner.
Yeah, so I think your points are well made, and I think it's a balance that we need to hold. And I think our role as an anchor organisation is incredibly important as we look to the future. In Lanarkshire, like many other boards, we're looking to our youth to understand also in that space. So there's the direct public health pieces that we're doing around vaccination and around better health, etc. And actually, we've just launched Our Health Together, which is a whole strategy about better care and better value for our population. But if I may use the example of our youth, we're looking to work more closely. We've begun the work out in our schools to inspire children, particularly from schools in deprived areas, to help people understand opportunities of coming into health as an employer. So to look at that opportunity and also to start to develop different ways and different pathways for people for whom ongoing university or college opportunities might not be appropriate. How can they come in from school? So we're starting with modern apprenticeships, looking at SQA qualifications that might then help children come in. So looking to inspire from a young age to help them understand those opportunities with that double edge of the wonderful pieces if they want to become part of our workforce one day, but if not, then learning through that healthy living and some of the key messages. We then want to help our young people as they come in through academies. So we have a care academy locally and also working with a number of academic institutions in Central Scotland and indeed with NHS Scotland Academy, again, to try to bring in further opportunities for particularly children from deprived backgrounds to come into an opportunity of employment. So it's that health, it's that education, employment and the onward benefits that of course come with all of that. So as part of our broader plan, I think those elements are really important, is that health sees itself both as a direct deliverer but also as a critical influencer, as an employer. And again, all the pieces that I've touched on for Lanarkshire as an example, and the challenge that we have with 52% of our population living in deprived areas, our staff belong to those communities and those are their families. And so what we see in our population is what we see in our staff group and vice versa. So we hope that through a number of different opportunities, and that's just but one, we can start to influence in our community. Thanks.
We're going to move on to mental health and escalation framework. I invite Tess White to lead on that theme. I also would appreciate some brevity just because we are against time, if that's all right. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. I've got two questions for Professor Gardner and two for Professor Archibald. So my first question, Professor Gardner, is 74% of your children and young people are waiting over a year to start treatment in NHS Lanarkshire. Why are the waits so long?
Significant challenges in our service in terms of the approach to design. However, we have done a really radical review of our CAMHS and psychological services for young people, and actually delighted to be part of the opening again of a new facility from the investment that's been put into our CAMHS services, and meet with some service users recently who were talking about the difference that that is making. The impact of that, though, is really significant. We are already reducing almost 50% from August of the year before to August of this year in terms of our CAMHS waits. And we're looking again to continue through this financial year to bring our waits down really significantly. We also are developing new ways of working in terms of having group opportunities for children to access. And again, trying to address some of the needs earlier in the pathway with children in schools and through some of the education in schools. But specifically to our CAMHS and psychological services, we're doing a whole range of improvement work that can be seen directly in our performance as it begins to change. Obviously, we were focused on our longest waits, but in the performance that you'll see now and going into the rest of this year, you will be seeing a very significant improvement across both CAMHS and psychological services, and that's through innovation, a refresh of our teams, and a really ambitious and visionary approach from the clinical teams who are driving those services.
Thank you. So there's a lot of work that's going on, but has the Scottish Government cut to mental health affected the mental health services in NHS Lanarkshire?
I think resource is a challenge in all parts of our system, but we have used the resources available and we've worked with the government. As I say, the recent example of the £1.5 million investment in a refurb of a building to provide an area where children are able, children and young adolescents are able to share their stories and talk about their issues. And actually, whilst it remains a challenge, I do think we've been able to focus, and through that focus, we are being able to bring about really significant change in performance, which, of course, every performance number is linked to that child and the difference that that's actually making for people.
OK, thank you. And Professor Archibald, so you talk about smoke detectors and you use that analogy, which I think is quite a powerful one. The independent report into Tayside's mental health services expressed concern over workforce planning. So what steps are Tayside taking to improve strategic planning, staff appraisal and exit interviews?
Thank you very much for the question. In terms of mental health services in Tayside, that's one of our key challenge areas, and I think that's well known. We had an independent oversight group working with us and they concluded their report. We're actually approaching on a whole system basis, if I might take 1 minute to explain that, convener. So it's with what's called the Tayside Executive Partners. That's the three council chief executives, myself and the Chief Inspector of Police, because we see it as a whole system approach to dealing with the challenges of mental health rather than it just being about acute phases of it. But you're entirely right. We do have challenges in terms of staffing, particularly in consulting staffing at the moment. There is a challenge across the whole of Scotland, but it is most acute in Tayside. We also look to make sure that we can fully staff all our nursing services. We're doing proleptic appointments of nursing graduates, and that means that in their last session their last allocation period to award or department, we're giving them both the offer of a job and the opportunity to spend their last session working in that department. And that has involved 70 mental health nurses and a total of 308 nurses in total for the whole of Tayside. So that's part of our engagement with the University of Dundee and indeed with the colleges regarding how can we retain a workforce in Tayside and make sure we can attract people in the future. In terms of our consultant body, we have a high number of locums, long-term locums, but that's not an ideal design of the service. And that's important because this is about designing for the future. And therefore, if we know that we're going to have these challenges regarding staffing, we need different models of staffing. 94% of mental health is delivered in community care environs and only 6% in acute services. In Tayside, there was a national report, national UK report came out last year, September, that said Tayside had more beds than 95% of the rest of the country and 95% more admissions than the rest of the country. And I think we need to get underneath that and understand why that should be the case. We want to design a preventative system in mental health and a community-based one. Our IJB for Perth and Kinross is taking the lead in terms of the strategic redesign of services, and part of that narrative is do we go to single sites for services, much as Jan referenced with her acute care, but in terms of our mental health services, and therefore we maximise the benefit of those staff that need to be in hospital environments. But I think it's really important that we also understand that 94% of service being delivered in the community, if we have more beds than most of the rest of the country, why is that the case and how do we redesign our services differently at the same time as seeking to recruit and making it an attractive place to work?
Thank you. So could you talk to us and share with us your thoughts on how you could continuing to drive change in mental health services, particularly in relation to the six areas of strategic focus highlighted by the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. That's quite a big question, given the time that we have. So if you wouldn't mind, if I could give you the high-level version, and then we might engage outside the room as your, as a local MSP to have a more detailed discussion. But the six were progress towards a single site, which I've tried to describe, and that's a strategic commissioning engagement that's being led by the IJBs, because it is a delegated function. But we contribute to it. In terms of streamline the priorities and the change programme from a document that was called Living Life Well, which was our strategic document. So we've accepted that we need to streamline that and have far quicker and clearer delivery times for certain parts of that ambitious programme. And that, again, has been worked on through our IJBs and the Health Board itself. In terms of making integration work and engaging with the workforce, that's both elements about how do we redesign the service and make it different. And you talked about engagement with our workforce, and there's a lot of work going on with that at the moment in terms of exit interviews and understanding why people leave, but also trying, as I say, with the 70 new recruits to make the place more attractive. And then there's engaging with patients and families, and that's been a huge challenge to us, because we have tried. But the important thing is, do people feel we've tried at the right things? And there has been feedback that we haven't. So what's being led again through the IJBs is a complete new structure of our engagement programmes with a multiplicity of groups so that we can hear the voices. Our original document was called Listen, Learn and Change. And we want to get that listening bit right and hear what the population want. And then finally, there's a continued focus on patient safety. We do have a concern that even with the beds we have being at the very high end of the UK provision, there are still times where I have to go into unfunded beds and try to get staff at short notice just because of the sheer levels of demand. And that brings me back to my analogy. Don't try and build more beds. Try to work out why people need admission and can we intercept that earlier. Very final example, we had a chap who was suffering from depression as a young man. He came part of a walking group in the Camperdown Parks, which was a thing. He's now a park ranger. He has friends. He is a poster boy, I guess, for the success that can be done. But it was a non-medicalised intervention. It gave the guy a job. It gave him hope. It gave him friends. It gave him social networks. And those are things I need help with, because they're not things Tayside provides alone. And that's why we're trying to do it with all our colleagues in Tayside. Thank you. Mm.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move to Dr. Gilhani, who's going to lead us on staffing issues. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to start by asking Professor Archibald about the high staff turnover rate, around 13%. What do you feel the main challenges are in your area for retaining staff?
So the level of 13% in analysing it has a lot to do with people going on to other jobs and retiral. The recent changes in pensions and the ability to bring people back to work that have retired will improve that position, we think, considerably. I'm doing some work with the University of Dundee at the moment, the business unit there, and what we're trying to do is cut through all the narrative and try to find out by asking people what happens in their jobs, what do they feel makes them feel rewarded, what would make them stay, what would make them consider what else they might do. And I'm very struck by the fact, having spent 30 years working in the Central Belt, recruitment beyond the Central Belt is more difficult. It just is. I returned to Tayside because I'm a Dundonian. Would I have gone there had I not been? Might be a different question. And therefore, one of the things we're trying to do with the universities, and particularly the medical and nursing schools, is say, how can we retain the people that train in Dundee, because they're our best capture? How do we retain our existing workforce by making them feel valued? And one of the things, and we are proud of, one of the things we're very proud of in Tayside is our commitment to partnership working in terms of working with our staff side and our trade unions. And they have been so supportive and so helpful through these last 4 years that I've worked there, and they've been a key part of what we're trying to do.
I have 13,000 people that work for me. We all need to work together and we all need to feel valued. And that means the essence of coming in and believing you can be successful in your job, rewarded and recognised. And that's been difficult these last 2 years, particularly with COVID. But I remain committed to that absolute statement that we value and we retain our staff. And I think, as I say, the pension rules in particular, having spoken to some of my consultant colleagues and others, will do that. But we talk a lot about nurses and doctors, understandably, because they're the big workforce. But there are other areas that challenge us at times in terms of allied health professionals, radiodiagnostics. But even beyond that, one of the challenges I have at the moment is with my estates department and trying to recruit trained staff to that area. So they need to be there to make sure everything works as it should. And therefore, that's why we've engaged with the University of Dundee. We wanted to cut through the narrative and actually be able to determine what is the causation and what can we do about it. And we'll develop a plan.
So you certainly have a plan of looking into to what's happening. I often hear from staff that it's what's always described as little things that make a huge difference. So on my visit to Air Hospital, they had a fantastic canteen and they provide hot food at night time. Is that something your hospital does?
We've got a fantastic canteen. There's hot food in the evening, but not overnight. And I think that's typical for everywhere. I might be wrong. But we also created 15 rest, recover and recharge rooms for people, RRR rooms. And the reason for them was to give staff places to go and sit and get a break from the work environment. And in there, we provide some basic teas and coffees, etc. During COVID, we actually provided food as well, but we've just given that a bit of a reflex. And the issue with that, again, is, as you say, small things. The biggest queue I could show you, when we talked about ED, the biggest queue I could show you is for fish and chips on a Friday at the Dundee canteen. And it's consultants that say to me, this is great. And they actually said to me, can we get the catering guy to come and talk to us about change? Because he's turned around the catering department. And you're right. It's those small things that make people feel valued and make people understand that we are actually listening to them and trying to provide for them. And I think our triple R rooms were a good statement of that. But as you say, the value of a good canteen, and I'm sorry, a product of those fish and chips, it makes a difference. And it's those sort of things we need to think about.
It really does. And if I could direct my last question to Jeff Ace on video. Looking through NHS Dumfries and Galloway, you've got 12% medical and dental vacancies in consultant roles and 11% in allied healthcare professional roles. So being even more rural, what challenges do you face and what are you doing to improve them?
Yeah, it's a staggering challenge and it's on a par with the financial issues that we were discussing earlier. I think two things. We're working very closely with University of West of Scotland, University of Glasgow and our Dumfries College that are next door to me here in Dumfries on the Crichton Park to look at our future vacancy projections. So what professions will we experience particular problems in and how we can optimise training offers in those professions. And I think ScotGem is the best example of that working well. When you see ourselves and other boards getting together with the education providers, getting together with local GPs and really providing a different route in for professions. And we locally have been astonished at the success of ScotGem. It's just been almost transformational in GP in particular capacity. But I think the second thing is to recognise we face a problem that's outside health here in Dumfries and Galloway and probably in rural Scotland as a whole. If we look at future population projections, our working age population falls, our older adult population increases. And we become, if nothing is done about that, we become a less vibrant economy. We become a potentially less attractive place for people and their families to relocate to. And I think in that sort of future, we will be constantly trying to push the rock uphill in terms of professional recruitment to bring people into the area that we want to locate here. We want them to see what fantastic opportunities we can provide, what fantastic facilities and teams that they can work with. So I think there's a real challenge also as to how we turn around that demographic future and say that the future of rural Scotland is not one of working age population decline, is not one of an increasingly elderly, perhaps economically inactive population, but is one of vibrancy, is one that is attractive to professions, to families to move into. So I think that's the much larger issue that we're working with our community planning partners, particularly the council, to try and change that bigger future. Because if that isn't fixed, I think the challenge for health will always be one of just how do we bring professionals into this community with their families to relocate here and to see exactly how brilliant working in rural Scotland can be.
Thank you. I have two questions. In the interest of time, I'll maybe just ask them both. The first thing is, in general, we understand and we recognise the staffing as a longer term solution. But if there were one or two things that we could do by working together that yous could do as the boards and the government here in Scottish Parliament could do, what would be those one or two things that might ease pressure in the next year or two? And the second question I have is around midwifery in particular. A lot of the figures that we see are always nursing and midwifery together. I've met with some midwives, and there was midwives in the Parliament last week, and they say that there are particular pressures around recruitment and retention of midwives, such an essential part of the healthcare system. So how do you find midwifery in your own areas? I'd be really interested to know.
Yes, so in terms of, if I start with the first question, in terms of that general element and how the Parliament can support, it's back to our policies being able to let us bring our systems back into balance. I know I made the point earlier, but I think speaking to staff, the biggest thing that's asked for in terms of retention, we often go to recruitment, but actually retention is almost more important, to look after the fantastic people that we have and then also to look to how we bring in more and make it a good place to work. There is a really positive piece to help tell our public about that piece. I think we've gone through a really challenging space of everybody clapped for the NHS and it was really positive. We've then gone into a space where colleagues are concerned about pay and conditions. But I think sometimes then there is a skewed view in the public that it's not a good place to work. They hear about the challenges that we work in. So I think the opportunity is there to help tell the people of Scotland of all the good work that's being done and the good experience that still can come from working in a healthcare environment, which of course we all love, but to try to encourage again the public to see some of that positive opportunity. The second element is linked to then the working conditions for the staff that we have, and that's linked to some of the reform that we've talked about. Some of the decisions that we'll need to make are brave decisions to change shape, to really radically do what's right for our population and make good places to work for our people going forward. And also, then that also comes on to education. The pieces that I touched on earlier, make it easier for people to come in, make recruitment processes easier. We know that how people are recruited now is quite different, how people respond to that. Sometimes these drop-in days where you come in, you're interviewed, you see, you talk. Those are the types of things that we need to do, and also build relationships with communities as early as possible in a child's life and with families, so that again we try to bring our families in. So that's in terms of the general piece. In terms of midwifery in particular, I think a lot of those elements actually play out and probably play out stronger because of some of the emotional part that goes round and the importance of those services. We know how much we value our maternity and indeed our neonatal and paediatric services, and community hold those very dear. So the element is around, again, as being able to create the right conditions, offer ways of allowing our staff in post to develop. We want to have a more sensitive ladder of development for people, so it's easier. You don't need to necessarily go out and do postgrad, but you can develop easier access, you don't need to come in fully qualified, these types of things. We want different pathways. Now, that will take time to lay down, but working in different ways to support people and to give them those opportunities, I think, are the most significant. And also in the environments that people are working in, we know often in maternity, as an example, there is loss, and that is really hard. What we've seen, again, through pandemics, the same issues. Our population have complex health needs. Our women who are coming into our services have more and more complex health needs. And actually, again, locally, if I look to just a recent period, we've had a number of people coming in and some really acute phases where we've had a number of women, much higher than we would have seen before, who are unwell in themselves or have complex health needs and they are pregnant. And so trying to make the career supportive and the development opportunities to learn both midwifery and be able to support and indeed develop those multidisciplinary teams and create areas like we're doing in Wishaw right now where people can have a birth when perhaps we know it's a stillbirth, etc., and make the whole experience better for families but also indeed for our staff. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Microphone, thank you. Just a quick question for Jeff Ace. It's regarding like international recruitment. So you've been quite successful about recruiting nurses, but I'm thinking not just a warm welcome and orientation and training is required, but a wider holistic approach like housing. Is housing a challenge for recruiting folk to rural, remote Dumfries and Galloway as well? And if so, like what can you do about it?
Housing was going to be my one ask to the Parliament in terms of what can help us. You're right, we've enjoyed our experience with international recruitment, non-EU recruitment. We've been relatively successful. We've got a couple of dozen nurses and other staff into the system. And we're able to wrap around initial accommodation support and orientate those individuals into the community. What we can't do is provide affordable housing. And that's a real problem in Dumfries and Galloway, and I'm sure throughout the rest of rural Scotland, is we are seeing significant difficulties for staff trying to move into the area of accessing that housing that's both convenient and affordable. So I think, again, for healthcare in rural Scotland to thrive over the next generation, there are a lot of non-healthcare things that need to be done around the economy and around our ability to house key workers in the right sort of affordable accommodation. So if I had that one ask to the Parliament, it would be to look at that housing pressure in rural Scotland and what could possibly be done to make it more attractive for companies to build here to provide affordable housing, particularly for key workers.
Okay. Tess White, would you like to join us if you have a question? If you're out there.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, convener. So, Professor Archibald, one question, if I may. An area where the smoke alarm definitely is going off is in staff turnover. So NHS Tayside has a 13% staff turnover rate. And now you're getting information from your exit interviews. What are the main challenges in retaining staff within your health board? Thank you.
Thanks very much. As I said, the initial analysis of the reasons for leaving have been dominated by people either being promoted or going to other jobs, and also by retiral. I think I'm right in saying that 25% of my mental health nursing workforce can retire in the next 3 years. And therefore, we need to find different ways of working with that, because life choices about retirement are clearly for the staff themselves. But that's why we need to understand the profile of who's leaving, as well as the reasons for, because the age of the workforce will be a very telling determinant of where we go next. And as I've tried to articulate, our emphasis has been on seeking to recruit, and coming back to our colleague's previous question, in the number of proleptic appointments we've made in Tayside this year from the nursing cohort, 40 of those are going into midwifery, and that is an area that we have a challenge in. So these are very focused actions to try to achieve real results. I think the engagement needs to go on with staff. We're trying to brand NHS Tayside as an employer of choice.
We can't make ourselves any closer to the central belt where there's a better concentration of staffing availability, so we need to make ourselves remarkable by maybe three things. One thing is our performance and our reputation as a high-performing board. The second is a caring board for its staff that looks after its staff and makes them feel valued and gives them opportunities. But the third and most important thing for me is a place where you come and you do your job and you see the benefit reflected by the high appraisal that you get from those using the service, their relatives and the communities we serve.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to move quickly to Mr. Torrance, who's going to talk about the issue with culture. Thank you,
Convener, and good morning, everyone. In the absence of a national dignity at work survey, how do you boards monitor bullying and harassment in the workplace? And just for the sake of quickness, are boards confident that national whistleblowing standards are being followed and that people with concerns are suitably supported? And I'll come to Mr. Professor Archibald first, please.
Thank you. In order to recognise the time and briefness, we have arrangements through our HR function, we have the whistleblowing function, and we also have our staff governance committee. And they analyse any reported cases of bullying and harassment and assure themselves that they were managed appropriately and the issues were resolved. I think it's important that in that context, there's a high emphasis on early resolution and trying to get people to work together. But if that doesn't work, then there are further actions that can be taken. Can I be assured? Yes, I'm assured through my staff governance process, and I'm also assured through the Area Partnership Forum, which is our meeting with all our staff side colleagues, because we have narrative there about confidence in the conduct and culture of the organisation. And it's not always the same in all areas, and we need to embrace that and understand why and address that where it's identified. But I am assured through those arrangements that we are not only aware of cases of bullying harassment, not only that we seek to resolve those, but we seek to learn to prevent them in the future.
Professor Gardner?
Yeah, so similarly, we have a range of approaches that we use. We very much value the relationship with our staff side colleagues, where we know that we get direct feedback from staff, but we also have, through those staff side colleagues, the assurance that we have a good interaction. We also have carried out an internal audit under whistleblowing to make sure that, again, our framework was in place and that they felt assured. That came back in November of 2022, noting substantial assurance and commending the process and the various routes in. Of course, we always remain alive to this. I think any organisation at its peril takes for granted that the culture is right. It's something that we live and breathe each day. But we do feel that we have done significant work and continue through staff wellbeing, listening to what the feedback comes through in iMatter surveys and other staff interactions, our staff side, and indeed some in our Area Partnership Forum and Staff Governance Committees and through the audit. Thank you.
Mr. Ace?
Anything that colleagues have said. The only thing I would add is what we're also finding useful locally are specific networks, so LGBT networks, Black and minority ethnic staff networks, visiting those and getting first-hand those opinions of what it's like to work in NHS Dumfries and Galloway is really rich information that may not be captured by some of the bigger survey work. So we're finding that quite a useful addition to all that my colleagues have said. Thanks.
Thank you.
Quick supplementary, Ms. Harper.
Thank you. It will be quick. Thank you. Just a quick question about what has been learned from the Sturrock review that has been taken forward in other NHS boards.
Mr. Ace, if you'd respond.
It feels quite a long time ago now, the Sturrock review. We had a joint session of our board and our staff side colleagues on all of the recommendations of Sturrock, prioritised our local action plan and tried to implement that as best we could. As I said, I think given what's happened during the pandemic, we almost need to start again with some of that work, because it's been such an unusual 3 years in the way that we've almost operated under an emergency command and control environment for two of those 3 years. So I think a good reset of where we are with Sturrock is probably something that we as a board will look at now. But as I say, at the time, we had that full review with joint review with our staff side to make sure that we were on top of all of the recommendations.
That's great. Well, if there's no further urgent points to make, I just want to thank our witnesses for coming, Professor Gardner, Professor Archibald, Mr. Ace, very helpful and detailed responses to the questions, I think. So if there's any further points we want to correspond with you on, we will follow up. But appreciate your time this morning. Thank you. We'll have a short break now, will we? Change over. It will be a very short one, I think. Less than a minute to the next scheduled panel. If I can just call the meeting to order. Thanks very much for your attention, and just want to start by welcoming our next panel joining us this morning. And it's comprised of Dr. Al Mathers, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Chief of Medicine for Women and Children's Services, who's joining us online. We've got Dr. Wael Agour, NHS Ayrshire and Arran, Lead Urogynecologist and member of the Scottish Government's Mesh Complications Working Group. And we have Dr. Anna Lamont, NHS NSS Medical Director, Procurement, Commissioning and Facilities, NHS National Services Scotland, who's joined us in the room. And we have Terry O'Kelly, Scottish Government Senior Medical Advisor, who's also joining us online. So I want to welcome all four of you today. Just want to begin our questions on the complex mesh surgical service with experiences of referral and access to the CMSS. Just to ask the panellists, what is the appropriate pathway or pathways into the service? How is this communicated to health boards, general practice and relevant specialties? And do the panel think that more could be done to increase awareness of the service? Don't know if there's anyone in particular who has a burning desire to lead us off. If not, I'll just direct it to Dr. Agour first. Thank you.
The pathway for treatment of mesh complications in women has significantly improved. And there are areas still where it can still be improved. That starts from the GP side, from the GP practices, through to secondary care, through to the national centre. There are also pathways directly from the GP directly into the national centre. Ideally, should go first through the local specialist centre in the local health board, were responsible for the patients, and then to the national centre. It's my understanding that there are direct referrals from GPs to the national centre straight away. I'm not sure how many of these referrals were there, but I think I read this somewhere in one of the documents that was circulated around. One important scope of improvement of the pathway is awareness of the GP of mesh complications. And it's my understanding that Scottish Government has made some significant steps into this. We've got to be clear that GPs have all sort of very wide, diverse conditions they're dealing with. And I think there needs to be some persistent communication on raising awareness of mesh complications, because this is an emerging field. And also raising awareness that these complications or the symptoms that women present with can mimic a wide variety of conditions, and there need to be a sort of a lower threshold of attribution of the presenting symptoms to the presence of a mesh device. So, rather than attributing the presenting symptoms to a common condition like menopause or endometriosis, it's important to look back at the history and find out whether there has been a urogynecology procedure for incontinence and prolapse, whether the mesh device has been implanted, and actually listen to the women themselves. If they say, I think there is something not quite right since the operation I had, then, I mean, our awareness as clinicians in secondary care and also GPs has increased. But there's certainly more improvement needs to be done, and the GPs need to be supported in this. And I think this came across in the survey that the committee has done, that more awareness of GPs is required. So this is one aspect of the pathway that could be improved.
Dr. Lamont?
Thank you. So in response to that critical feedback that we received from women looking for surgery and support for mesh complications, I think, first of all, it's important that I express sincere regret, both on a personal level and on behalf of NSS, for the difficulties they've experienced. We do appreciate the courage it takes to share such lived experience, you know, because the challenge it is to actually share such personal information. It is critical, I think, that we acknowledge the difficulties that they've experienced, and that we do look at the pathway variations, both in terms of individual boards, the lack of cohesion in the referral, and that lack of information around GPs and local specialists that we've heard about. I do understand the stress that the women experience, actually, in terms of trying to access this and that challenge that they describe in that feedback. Back in June 2022, we established a clear collaborative pathway for referral through independent providers, both in the US and down to Bristol. And as a result of that pathway, which was shared with the boards and shared with specialists, there have been 37 women so far referred for independent provider. That doesn't mean that we're content with that, and we are looking to continue to improve. And I think reflecting on the responses, as has been mentioned, there is a clear need to improve that communication that we have with the women all the way through that pathway, particularly within primary care and that journey between primary care and the local specialists. And I think reflecting on that, we should now be looking to communicate more directly with GPs about the need to raise awareness of mesh complications. It's important that this survey work continues, and I'm sure that Dr. Mathers will describe some of the more recent survey work, but we do need to learn from this feedback and to continue to improve. And where we can improve, we will improve, and we will continue to ensure that the services we can provide are both effective and efficient. And I think that's really, we can agree that that's the least we can do for these women.
Dr. Mathers, would you agree with that assessment, and what can be done in practical terms to increase awareness of the service?
Echo the two previous speakers' comments about just the difficulties encountered with patients that have been harmed in this way. Just to correct, just to be clear, the Mesh Centre does not take referrals from GPs directly. Now, there is a historical element to this, and it may be that GPs in the health board area refer to one of the urogynecologists, but if the patient has a requirement for a mesh centre MDT, then in those circumstances the patient is referred to the mesh MDT by local secondary care using the electronic form that we insist on since October 22. Going back to the, obviously the Mesh Centre gets referrals in. How those patients are initially seen and triaged and the awareness out there will be very different in different parts of the country. And it's a testament to the fortitude of a lot of the patients who will not take some of the responses that are in their survey for granted and push for referral. So I think more national awareness, better local awareness and local referral patterns will all help, because the Mesh Centre is at the top of a pyramid here.
Thank you very much for that. Mr. O'Kelly, would you like to offer an assessment on the current pathways and increasing awareness?
Can I make a comment?
Yes, certainly.
Yeah, so Mr. Kelly here, so Terry Kelly here sitting in Aberdeen. So I think the we are aware of issues expected that there will be difficulties between patients and clinicians' symptoms.
Oh, we're struggling with your sound a little bit.
The chief medical officer has already written out to primary care regarding this, stressing the importance the patients listen to and when they're reporting symptoms. We have also worked with colleagues in the rest of the United Kingdom, and Health Education England have prepared and have up and running an education programme for primary care concerning mesh and mesh-related complications. the various rights, etc., have been addressed, and this will be available in Scotland in the very near future. We'd hoped it would be available by now. Unfortunately, we do have a different electronic platform for learning education in healthcare here in Scotland, the TORA system, and the programme is being modified for that. In the very near future, we will have an education programme available for all in primary care, and the Chief Medical Officer will write out primary care again at that time to advertise this and to promote the programme. I think with regards to the pathway also, I think visibility for patients does need to be improved, and I think we would like to work with the service generally around that. Whether this is available on the Complex Mesh Centre site, website, or whether it is through the NHS Inform is perhaps to be decided. We have an upcoming meeting of our accountable officers where this can be discussed in greater detail. But I think it is very important that the initial interface between patients and clinicians is favourable, and the patients do feel as if their issues are being taken seriously and that their care is being taken forward in a reasonable fashion.
Thank you. Get a supplementary from Dr. Gulhani. Yeah.
Thank you. I mean, it's important to say that I am a practicing GP. So, Dr. Agar, you spoke about the pressures on GPs with the number of things that we need to be aware of. And I can give you examples, you know, CKD, brain tumour, they've come to Parliament and they're pressing for GPs to be more aware of these as well. But I'm sure you're aware that we don't always know patients have had mesh when we get our letters. We don't know what the surgical thing that actually happened, the procedure that actually happened was. All we know is someone went into urology and has come out. So is it not better to also have a central access point for the women to be able to call directly if they know they've had surgery and had problems since surgery? And, you know, that's an easy one. If someone tells me I've had problems since surgery, my first thought is third surgery. But common things are common, and that's not always our first thoughts.
Yes, yeah, I totally agree. Not only that, some GP will not be able to know whether a mesh device has been inserted. Some women themselves do not know that some devices have been inserted. Some women present with a common complaint, for example, like bleeding after the menopause. They get investigated for postmenopausal bleeding, and we just found by incidentally that there is a mesh exposure that is causing the bleeding rather than what the most common cause for the postmenopausal bleeding. There used to be a central helpline. Scottish Government has put in a central helpline, a national helpline for women to contact. And I think that was at the height of the crisis a few years ago, but Terry could correct me on that. And I think when the crisis was sort of became more awareness UK-wide, I think the national helpline moved to become a UK national helpline. So I'm not sure whether it is still going on, but it was more of a, it's my understanding of this, is that the national helpline was more of a supportive service and more of a signposting service to the women. It's my understanding also that the women who engage with the national helpline has found it incredibly helpful. What I'm not sure about just now is whether it is ongoing, whether it's still active, whether it is still someone at the end of the line answering patient questions. It used to be a specialist nurse who was mesh aware. And I think there was one of the nurses here in Glasgow, and then the service moved to England. But sorry.
What's important is if no one's sure if a mesh has been implanted, if a woman calls that helpline, they need to be able to find out.
A national helpline to be able to find out will need to go into the patient record. Yeah. And those who have access to the hospital record will be clinicians like myself, right? So I need to know whether the patient is presenting with problems in relation to mesh did have a mesh device or not. So clinicians in local hospital and local health ward are best set to find out this piece of information to support the woman and her GP and receive the referral when it happens. So I'm not sure how a central helpline will, or the central helpline that is already existing, would support that.
Thank you. So I think a central helpline is very useful when there is that public awareness. And I should emphasise I am also a practising GP as well. There is a challenge for all clinicians to be aware of all complexities and all details. And it's one of the reasons why this pathway is a referral from specialist. However, we can do more to improve awareness. I think we also have to consider that if a specialist helpline is made available or is available, the women first of all need to know that they need to access it. And actually that first step is the critical step. A central helpline would also not have access to the records. So while it can be reassuring and supportive and helpful and guide, it can't provide that critical information that's required. And I think has already been spoken about, resources such as NHS Inform, having those accessible resources in places where people would expect to find them is where to put sort of information like this. There is a challenge in terms of in Scotland and having information and guidance for GPs, and as we've spoken before already in the introductory statements about that educational platform for doctors and about how they access that information. But certainly having a helpline is only useful if people actually have already realised they need to phone it. And so you need to be able to have that information provided in a different form that's accessible. And we also need to understand, actually, from the women themselves. We've seen today, actually, we've looked at the evidence, and actually that it's about that feedback about how people's journey and their experience of that journey. So before we would put into place any kind of education or support for women, we would need to hear from them about how they look for information, how they would then first come to understand that they needed that. And I think for GPs, we'd also need to recognise that they cannot be specialists in every area. But it is about actually having that awareness that somebody is presenting with a concern that then needs to be referred on to that specialist who can then take that more critical view.
Mr. Kelly, did you have any points you wanted to raise here? Do come in, Mr. Kelly.
So we did, at the height of the concerns around mesh, and I suppose the maximum activity and publicity, etc., back in 2015 to 2019, I suppose 2018, we did have a helpline established and staffed, but the number of calls fell off quite dramatically and remained at a very low level. It was then unreasonable to continue. So that was withdrawn, and there are now information pages on NHS Inform. I think so we're all sort of bringing it up, I suppose, as far as our practices, but sitting here in secondary care as a practicing surgeon, I think the NHS patient care works best when it is integrated across primary and secondary care. And I think I'm a great believer that the patient's best advocate is their GP, and their first contact should be with primary care through clinicians, whether that is medical or non-medical, to explain problems and those for them to go forward. And then there is that important action interaction with secondary care. And I think that if we dismantle that, and we are seeing that sadly now in medicine, in the NHS here, because of the issues post-COVID, that when that integration breaks down, we end up with problems of communication, problems of ensuring that patients who might have many intercurrent issues, that where those are overlooked and not taken account for, we end up with, I think, practice poor medicine. We need to try and avoid that, if at all possible. And going back to what Dr. Agar was saying about the patient presenting, let's say, with postmenopausal bleeding, that is a reason why a patient should be assessed and referred, and it will become apparent that mesh is the underlying cause. So one would like to think that standard practice should persist, but it is important that general practitioners' primary care is tied into the ongoing management of patients. Otherwise, we will end up with poor medicine and patients who will suffer as a consequence.
Thank you. I think Evelyn Tweed wanted to come in on waiting times and referrals. Yeah.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Yes, I would like to ask Mr. O'Kelly some more about his comments about educating GPs. Sorry, your comments earlier on were really difficult to hear. Yeah, I think the sound has been amended now, so you're sounding much better. So I'll go back to what you were saying. I think there is obviously an issue with referrals. GPs don't always know how to deal with these. I think that is obviously having a knock-on effect on when people are being seen. Did you say earlier that the Scottish Government have an education programme to help GPs? What are you doing immediately to help them?
The Chief Medical Officer has already written out to primary care, drawing their attention to issues with regard to mesh and alerting them that patients may present that they need to be listened to and issues acted upon. We have also worked with colleagues across the United Kingdom, and Health Education England have developed an education and training package for primary care. Now, unfortunately, the electronic platform for education here, medical education here in Scotland, is different from that in England. And at the moment, the programme is being modified. I had hoped that this would already be in the domain of primary care for their education training. And we expect this to be available very soon. So I apologise, there has been a delay in this coming. And once it is available, it will be, Chief Medical Officer will write again to general practitioners advertising and drawing their attention to this. And hopefully that will, in addition to what's gone before, will help to address issues that have been described. And all we can do, I think, really is to promote this education, then to canvas opinion from primary care, their thoughts, but also from patients. Has their initial experience with colleagues in primary care, do they still have the same issues? And if they do, we need to make further modifications.
Thank you. And can the committee be told why are there such long waits between appointments? And to anyone that would like to come in here.
Go for it, Dr. Lamont.
So I would ask that we a bit of clarity on the question, because we do need to recognise the difference between different stages of the appointment. So there's a referral in from a specialist to the complex mesh service. And there have been delays in that, and the capacity of the complex mesh service has recently increased. The number of people they're seeing per clinic has improved, and that waiting time is coming down. And I'll let Dr. Mills speak about more about that. There is then the waiting time from a decision to have surgery to actually then have that surgery undertaken. That waiting time has been reducing, and going forward after this month, we're going to be, or they are offering surgery within 12 weeks of a decision being taken. I do, though, want to just point out that a large part of what the complex mesh surgery service is about is not doing surgery. We talk about it being a complex mesh surgery service, but actually more women, after speaking to and understanding the complexities and the challenges and what they may gain or may not gain, or may actually have issues with a surgery, then opt not to have surgery or opt to have some other form of treatment. So it is really important to understand that the complex mesh surgical service is more than surgery. It is also about deciding positively not to have surgery, or perhaps to delay having surgery. And it is that surgery is not a procedure without cost to these women. You know, we talk about the financial costs, but it is important to understand that the time and and the recovery period, and also the complications that may happen after that surgery itself. But to come back to your issue about waiting times, there is then also the time that if a decision is made for referral to an independent provider, so to Dr. Veronica or Dr. Hashim, and at the moment an MDT will make that decision, the decision will then be referred back to the local consultant specialist, who will then come to NSD with a request to refer out the area into either US or Bristol. That decision is taken typically within 48 hours and would then make a referral. Dr. Ronick has been very good about booking appointments, working with the women to find a date that works for them. We will organise travel. So that time is typically less than 6 weeks, typically a lot less than 6 weeks. So the waiting time, which I think people tend to focus on, quite rightly so, is the time from being referred into the complex mess service to being seen. And, you know, we acknowledge the challenges in that. And some of that is reflected in these survey responses. It is improving. And certainly the time from a decision for surgery to having that surgery is now a lot better than it was.
Dr. Mathers, would you like to come in on this point?
Well, I think from the papers we've demonstrated that we are reducing the waiting times for first assessment. I think one of the things that came out from our own feedback was that women were finding it quite overwhelmed, the way the initial referrals were made, and the patients were seen by a large number of clinicians at one time, and that we got feedback to say that that was quite overwhelming for some individuals. So we have adjusted the process to facilitate that. Just like every other specialty, we are trying to manage quite considerable waiting pressures. But we have a good news story in the sense that whilst I would still be very uncomfortable with the length that people have to wait, it is something that has been steadily going down, as you will see from the data that we presented. And we expect it to be reduced by another further 8 weeks for the summer.
Can I also ask what treatment is being offered to patients that are on these long waiting lists? What happens to these women while they're waiting?
Is that to me?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So they have been referred by they've been referred by a GP, but in primary care, obviously, or the secondary care, rather. They're referred by the GP to secondary care, and then through that to the mesh centre. So within that time, some of their problems will be pain management, psychological, physiotherapy. They don't have to wait until they are seen at the mesh centre to have those aspects managed locally, but every part of the health system has differential waiting times with regards to the more holistic aspects of things, as opposed to just the functional bit of identifying with the individual patient whether she feels that surgical treatment of some form is what she would have a preference for.
Thank you. Karen Malkin.
Thanks, convener. Thank you very much for the information. It's much appreciated. I wondered whether Dr. Lamon or Dr. Matters might be able to, just for the record, be clear. I'm interested to know, you provide some information, but you know, I think it would be useful to know exactly what the average waiting time is and the longest waiting time. So actually, how long has the longest woman had to wait to be seen within the service?
Am I live? Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
So the there are patients that have waited, you will see that from their survey, ostensibly for years. And one of the problems is to know exactly what that route for an individual into the service would be. There are also women who will, you know, we've quoted an average waiting time here, but there obviously is a huge range simply because there will be some people with problems that have been identified that require more urgent treatment, and there will be other patients who will have other needs arise and will defer their appointment. So it is actually quite, as far as the longest goes, then I think we have to take the evidence from the women's survey to say that some of them have waited years. What we are trying to do is, from the reset of establishing the mesh centre, is to consistently bring that down, and to also identify why there would be long waiters within that. We do that for all of the other gynaecological services, or I'm sure for all of the board services.
Can I, sorry, are you, it's just to be clear, so there's women referred to the service, but we can't be clear why they haven't been seen yet. It's just a long process sometimes for people. Is that what we're saying?
Sorry, if you are electronically referred to the service through the process that was introduced in October 22, then you will be put into that process, and the average wait for that service in 21-22 was 72 weeks. We have moved it down to 55 weeks, and we expect it to be 47 weeks by June 2023. So that is in part a reflection on increased capacity, and also this acknowledgement that we were overwhelming women by them seeing an awful lot of individuals when they actually attended. No one in any way is doubting that coming to be seen in this kind of service with the long history of problems that they've had is something that can be dealt with in a short appointment.
I don't know if Dr. Lemon has anything further.
Only say that as the commissioner of the complex mesh service, we do have exact details of both median waiting times, longest waiting times, shortest waiting times on a quarterly basis, and certainly that very detailed data can be provided on request if that's what's being looked for. I do think, though, when we are looking at this, we need to acknowledge that we have had the COVID and winter pressures, and that has impacted on the Glasgow service, and that's not to excuse, but it is to explain why there has been perhaps, you know, a pause and delay in terms of catch up. But I also want to acknowledge actually what the efforts that GGNC and the Complex Mesh Service has made in this year in terms of catching up and improving that access time. And the outpatient clinic has doubled its capacity and is now seeing double the number of women that was being seen last year on a week-to-week basis. And that's the number that's critical, less than the surgery-wise, which has also improved and is now going to be under 12 weeks. But that number of women, essentially, it does mean that waiting list will be coming down. The longest waiting time is not always the best measure. It is a measure that I can understand is of interest, but sometimes people will choose not to actually want to delay appointments. They don't work for some particular women and they need to be changed. So we do tend to work by the median waiting time, and we can provide that on a very detailed quarterly basis, and I have that available here.
Can I just one more question? I would really appreciate the data. It's just, you know, obviously people come to us as individuals as well, and it's important for us to be able to feed back, and these long, long waits for women have been going on for years, and it is our job to scrutinise and make sure that everything has been done. The next question that I'm interested in is if women have chosen the other option of to go down south or to go across to Dr. Veronica's, is there anybody currently waiting on a referral on in the system, or does everyone who has requested that to date have a referral on or has had their referral on?
So to the pathways I spoke about is a referral that MDT will work with the women to understand what their preference is. And we do have a preference service, which is unique in this MDT, about whether they wish to be referred to an independent provider or not. They also have a choice of which independent provider. And 37 women have chosen so far, and those people have been referred. Of those 37, 29 have been referred now on, And the difference between that number is because those are the numbers that are with local health boards awaiting referral to NSD for approval for financial and for arranging the transport and the surgery. It takes 48 hours typically. In fact, we're not aware of, before this, I did ask the team if they were aware of any that had taken more than 48 hours, and they were not. Within 48 hours, we will approve that, and we will then get in touch with Dr. Veronicus. There is a clear pathway that's been worked with the boards, and we have a mechanism by which the information is shared with Dr. Veronicus, and he will then contact the women. So far, with Dr. Hashim, only one surgery has so far taken place, but that again is to relating to the patient preference for the date of surgery. So I am confident that there is no significant delay between the decision being taken for referral to an independent provider and that then being arranged.
And so the figures you've quoted, does that mean that there's eight women just waiting out to be referred, that have chosen a different pathway that are waiting to get their final referral on?
So the multidisciplinary team, the MDT, I apologise for using acronyms, we are used to that in the NHS. So the multidisciplinary team with the complex mess service will work with the women to decide that is the route that they wish to go down. That referral is then passed back to the local specialist service because the complex mess surgical team themselves are not able to make that referral. That referral has to come from their own health board. Once that referral is made, it then comes to NSS, ourselves, and we will then authorise that and make arrangements. So there is a short delay, usually in the matter of days or a week or so in between the referral being going back from the MDT and being returned to us at NSD.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Emma Harper, you may have a supplementary and also some questions on communication.
Yep, I think I'll go direct to the communication parts of it, and I'm just looking at the NSS website and then Greater Glasgow's website. Greater Glasgow's one's a bit clunky for actually finding the information that people need, so that's obviously not something that you can control, probably, Dr. Lamont, but the NSS pathway is quite clear in what the process would be. I'm just interested in how people are communicated with, how the women are communicated with from the start and then the referral and as it goes on. Is there open dialogue? Is it by contact with a direct clinical nurse specialist, for instance? What is the process for communicating to keep people feeling like they're well informed?
Thank you. So the responsibility for communication and care rests with their own health board. So that initial decision around referral is with the MDT from Greater Glasgow and Clyde. So they will be aware that referral decision has been made. Their own specialist will then communicate with them about that referral being made. As soon as we receive that referral, we will contact the women directly. So once we've received a referral at NSS, we then establish a direct line of communication. And Dr. Veronicus and Dr. Hashim also directly contact the women and arrange a surgical date based upon their preference. We will then continue that contact around arranging transport, travel, expenses, and we will then contact them again when they return to ensure that surgery has taken place. There's then also information that's then passed back from Dr. Veronicus and Dr. Hashim back to the local health board, to their specialist, about their inpatient stay. However, I think we, both from the feedback that we received from the critical survey feedback and the continuing feedback, we're not resting on our laurels here. We do need to look at where we can improve this. I think that some of those areas of communication around websites, we can continue to improve that. And I think particularly it's about improving that handover, those care between the return back from the US or back from Bristol, back to their GPs and back to their specialists. It's not an area that we can directly influence, but I think we can share the feedback and we can then look at how we can make that pathway better. And as I said in my opening statement, where we can improve, we will improve, and we have a responsibility to do that.
And how are women then advised about waiting times, for instance, or what do they expect, or feedback around the process is? Is the communication done electronically by email? Is it done by letter? Is it done by telephone call? How do we make sure that everybody feels as if their preferred way of communicating is the way that's done for each individual person?
So regarding communication around waiting times and the pathway before it reaches NSS, I will refer you both on to Dr. O'Kelly and also Dr. Mathers, because their responsibility primarily around that part of the pathway. For ourselves, we will contact the women directly by telephone. And also there's sometimes we have some communication by email, but generally we try to avoid communication by email because in terms of that personal information sharing, and we're very sensitive to the challenge actually that these women have in terms of sharing information, and we want to make sure that it's consistent. Dr. Ronicus arranges teams video calls to arrange those consultations, and also checks in with the women once they've come back as well by video consultation as well. So primarily our part of that communication is by telephone, but I will defer to my colleagues in terms of the communication about waiting times.
If you have any follow-ups from Ms. Raquel, would you want to come in? Just bear with
me.
Could you start again? Sorry, because we're muted for a few seconds. Sorry.
You can hear me right. So I do apologise, and I'm sorry that I'm joining you remotely, but there are reasons for that. So Anna, I think, has concentrated on pathway and communication between patients, service, NSS, and Dr. Veronicus, and Professor Hashim. But of course, a lot of patients, majority of patients, are coming from secondary care, from their local clinicians to the Complex Mesh Centre in Glasgow, following an NHS route. And I think I would like to draw the committee's attention to the work of the Patient Engagement and Public Involvement Team in Glasgow, who have looked at communication specifically as one of the domains in their surveys, and I hope we have seen it. But clearly what they have shown is that they've asked questions, they've listened to what patients have said, and they've made changes, colleagues made changes in Glasgow. And it would appear from the results of that survey, there's another iteration due soon, that the performance, the outcomes is now at a very high level with very significant results with regard to patient satisfaction. I don't know if Alan wants to say more about that.
Dr. Mathers, would you care to come in on this point as well?
Confirm that when the patients are seen at the Mesh Centre and elect to have their treatment, then we send back a standard letter to the referring consultant to ask for referral to the relevant party, or we obviously list them for care at GGC if they wish their surgery in the Mesh Centre. So there isn't a, because we insist on an electronic referral pattern, we are able to just put these answers, the outcomes back faster.
Okay, Gillian McKay.
Thanks, convener. Following on from that, I'll maybe go back to Dr. Mathers. Earlier, I think it was yourself that referenced the amount of information that women receive as a result of going down this pathway. How is that information followed up for women? Is there a standard way of communicating this in writing or another way to ensure that after appointments or after an initial appointment, women can go and digest this information in a way that's accessible for them?
So the short answer is that we are always trying to improve the communication, but I don't have specific data to tell you the degree of that. We have had feedback to suggest that we are doing well. We have now had two cycles of feedback And we will have another two cycles by June 2023. So I would be grateful if I could take that question away and just find out more.
No problem. Sorry,
Gavina. Yeah, no, that would be really useful. I wonder if this may be needing the same treatment for this question. How do you communicate how women can keep themselves well and receive alternative support while they're on waiting lists? Many of them will be experiencing pain and a variety of other symptoms, and long waits will exacerbate or continue those presentations. So is there a current standard way that women receive information of where to seek additional support or how to keep themselves well while waiting for appointments or for surgery?
So if I just come in on that, obviously the individual women will see a range of specialists, including psychologists and doctors, depends on their particular needs. So if they have, and we will deal with some people more urgently than others because they do have a septic issue or, you know, they just clearly are triaged into a more urgent phase. The other aspect of all of this is that one has to be careful when women have comorbidities. So it's not just mesh. They will come with rheumatic problems, diabetes, etc., etc., and they will have a whole stack of potentially different medicines, etc. So one has to be very careful that you don't, that's where a general practitioner who has got a very much better handle of drug interactions, etc., ensures that we have no risk of causing medical problems by intervening in areas that we shouldn't be primarily responsible for. So, the centre does attempt to deliver a holistic approach to a wide-ranging problem, and surgery is not always the offered or preferred solution to that. Does that answer your question satisfactorily?
Yes, it does. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm going to invite Mr. Torrance to lead on the next theme. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. Dr. Mavers, I think this is for you. How many women were seen by a service where surgery was not advised and where other management or treatments were advised instead? I do know the committee asked for this information before today's meeting.
So I will have to... I have data on the patients that elected to have surgery and had surgery. I don't have the answer to the precise question that you have posed at my fingertips. I'm sure we can look into that. The other thing that's probably worth emphasising is that some women are given an offer and they go and think about it sometimes for as long as a year. So we will only, if someone is waiting and not determined whether they want surgery, then we do have a system of follow-up contact, and then after a year, seek them to be re-referred simply to ensure that they are not lost.
Thank you. Dr. Lamont.
Thank you. So I do have the data. So referring to the financial years 2021-22 and so far 2022-23 as well, out of 165 first assessments seen by the Complex Mesh Service, 59 patients have opted either for conservative treatment or to defer the decision on surgery. 56 surgeries have been carried out, and this is as of 31st of March. 13 were on the waiting list for surgery in GGNC, Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And we've had 37 independent provider referrals.
Thank you for that. The Complex Mesh Surgical Service submission states that the service is primarily a surgical service. To what extent are witnesses confident that women engaging with the service are given a clear understanding about what it can and can't do in providing terms of treatment?
So I will pass this in a moment on to my colleague, Dr. Mathers, speaking specifically from the GNC. You're absolutely right that this is commissioned as a surgical service. And I think when we speak about the complex mesh surgical service, we tend to think about the surgical service. However, a significant part of this is about assessment, about the experience in assessing how much actually mesh may be still there after partial removals, the contribution of mesh and other complexities. We've heard people, you know, talk about comorbidities. What we mean by that is about other concerns, the problems. It's also recognising that mesh was will have been inserted for a concern in the first place. A significant part of that service is actually about the expertise in assessing these women who've got really complicated and complex concerns. And it's around actually understanding what can be done to help them. The mesh service provides it provides the assessment, the scanning, psychological support, pharmacological support as well, and actually what medicines can help with pain and other complications. And then obviously it does provide that centre of expertise for surgery. So I made the point earlier, and I will reiterate it, that although we talk about it being the complex mesh surgical service, it really is the complex mesh service. It's really to acknowledge that the women that have been harmed by mesh, really, it is a whole system, it's a whole complex form of complaint. It's not just about actually doing surgery. If surgery was what we could do for all these women to solve all their problems, actually this would be quite a simple service. But it is far more complex than that, and the complexity of the service reflects that.
Thank you. I think Mr. Kelly wanted to come in on this point.
I suppose just to support Anna there, that when we undertook the work back in 2020 regarding the need for a centre for the management of mesh complications, it was thought that at that time that surgery would be the answer for women or for most women. But over time, it's been absolutely clear that for a number of women, mesh removal is not necessarily the best way forward. And clearly that those decisions are made with sharing information and with meaningful conversations between clinicians and patients, patients empowered to make decisions about themselves and their health. So I think that the service was developed with a holistic foundation, and that's going to be really important, I think, as we go forward. And suspect that more women coming to the service will may not go down the path of surgery, and certainly that is the experience in the other centres across the United Kingdom. It's very interesting. We had a summit of the mesh centres in London in December, and that was one of the key messages that came forward, that surgery might be an answer for some, but not for all. And even if surgery does go forward, full mesh removal, that patients will need non-surgical care and other interventions in the future. It's important that we have that expertise.
I understand Dr. Mathers wishes to respond on this point as well.
To emphasise that the patients who elect not to have surgery aren't left bereft of care. And so in a GGC patient, might see a urogynecologist in the mesh centre, but then if they elected not to have surgery, they still can be referred to a urogynecologist subspecialist in the service, as they could if they came from Lothian. They would go back to a specialist in that area, because as Dr. Lamont said, it's not just about pain. There are some women who will have continence issues, recurrent urinary tract infections, things that will require ongoing specialist care in that particular area.
Dr. Gurge, do you wish to respond to this?
Yes, it's just to confirm that the survey conducted by the committee, one of the respondents did mention the identity of the service, and I think everyone agrees that it is not just a surgical service, it's a holistic service, as we're saying. So it's whether this holistic service is delivered in the Mesh Centre or in the local health board. I think that needs to be communicated very clearly to the women so they do not feedback in a subsequent survey that there are still concerns about the identity. So that could come in the MISH, in the centre information leaflet or the information leaflet that perhaps we provide locally in the hospital, is that this is a holistic service and surgery is just part of it. I think we really need to consider perhaps whether we need to keep the name surgical in the title.
Supplementary from Mayor Harper.
Yep, thanks very much, Convener. Just, you've both said, Dr. Lamont and Dr. Argyr, that it's about a holistic approach, and that's something that, just in reading the notes, there seems to be information come out about continuation of feelings of being let down, prolonged and continued anxiety, already disappointment because the expectations were already low, and therefore expectations were not met, and it seems there in conveyance of lack of empathy for the experiences, and it's almost like there needs to be a Maggie Centre equivalent for the people that have had mesh injuries, right? And you know, it's quite difficult to read some of what's been presented. How would you describe or talk about the whole holistic approach, because I know psychologists are involved and clinical nurse specialists in that. So how would you see the progress being taken forward based on feedback from the surveys about people's experiences?
So, I mean, in response to the survey, and I said earlier on that I personally, and on behalf of NSS, you know, we sincerely regret that that has been the experience. And you talked about how do we progress, and I believe actually we have progressed, but that's not to be complacent. And the surveys that have been published just in the last week, and surveys that will be published by Greater Glasgow and Clyde, I believe do show that we have progressed. And I can certainly point to the information that we have and the feedback about providing the independent provider pathway. And actually, it is my thanks to Scottish Government and to my colleagues here for highlighting this issue, for progressing it and to making it possible to have this independent provider pathway, which is one option. But also that we do have this specialist service, which continues to be responsive. And I do believe that the continued survey response will show how we are responding, and Dr. Mathers can speak about how particular pieces of feedback have been acted on to change how the way that care is being delivered in the service, and I have said where we can improve we will improve, and we are improving.
To invite Dr. Gohani.
Thank you. I'm not sure if Dr. Lamont or Dr. Agar would be the best person to answer, but Dr. Mathers referenced the specialist urogynecological specialist, but as of July 2022, there is a vacancy. There is no consultant in post. So my question is, how does this impact the service?
I would probably refer this back to Dr. Mathers, but I would also say that there is an active recruitment for that position, and we're also looking at how the service can be supported by other areas in Scotland to fill that position. The numbers at the moment of women that are being seen surgically through in the clinic are below the capacity that could be seen if we were functioning and recovered entirely from COVID pressures. So at the moment, I do not believe that that vacancy is significantly affecting the waiting list, and that's reflected in the improvement in waiting times. However, as I've said, it's not to be complacent, and we are actively recruiting, and we are also looking at how that support can be provided from elsewhere.
Just to come into this, so it's yes, I do agree with that. There are urogynecologists already in the service, and there are two colorectal surgeons, which is absolutely wonderful. However, the absence of a urologist is a concern. I understand the service has done it. I mean, I'm not part of the service, but I do refer to the service. The absence of a urologist is a concern. The vast majority of these mesh devices are implanted close to the bladder, and this is where the urology specialist comes in. Clearly, there has been engagement with urology before. There was a urology member in the service before, and I think it's quite important that the service ensures that a urology joins the team, because that will improve the confidence in the care from both clinicians and patients.
Thank you.
To come in as well. Do you wish to come in, Dr. Mithers? Yeah. If you just wait for your microphone.
Just to be very clear, that we have urogynecologists who come from gynecology and urologists. Both of those are at present in the UK services that are having a great deal of difficulty recruiting to and appointing to. But as Dr. Agur mentioned, we did have an arrangement with Lothian, and we have developed a specialist in Lothian who we will be hoping that they will be able to come to Glasgow to work from their contract in NHS Lothian. And we continue to sculpt and trying to attract a urologist to the current post, but we are in no way complacent about the need to have urologists in this service.
Thank you. Dr. Lamont, I don't want to get into a comparison. So what I'm looking for is sort of reasoning. So NHS England has established a number of specialised services for women with mesh complications. And so how many of those services have been rolled out, and what differences do they have? And if not, why?
So my understanding is there are 9 specialist services that have been developed in NHS England. And that reflects the difference in population sizes between England and Scotland. The specialist mesh service in Glasgow and the specialist mesh service in England are, there is the option for referral between them. Certainly there is the option there for NHS England if the woman chose that they did not wish to have surgery, similar to the independent provider pathway that can be referred up to Glasgow and Greater Glasgow and Clyde. I'm not aware of any women that have taken that option yet. And I think that reflects the evolution of services. The service in Greater Glasgow and Clyde certainly is a very advanced service, and the expertise is recognised nationally in that. And when I mean UK nationally, not just Scotland nationally. So I'm confident that the service that we have in Scotland is UK leading. And that certainly, as Dr. Kelly speaks about, that there's been recent conferences and there is that shared experiences. And there is a move to credentialing, which has not been spoken about so far, but it's really just to acknowledge that is work that continues to be developed, and there is an expectation that once that is up and running, that all the surgeons within GGNC will meet the requirements for that and will be effectively credentialed as well.
Thank you. And one final, hopefully quick question, Dr. Agar, if I could ask you, whenever we talk about mesh, specifically in this environment with all the concerns we have, the specialist mesh service that we have, people are concerned about implantation of mesh in other ways, in other devices, other types of mesh, with other types of surgery. And I suppose my question is, do you feel that those patients having mesh in different scenarios is safe and something that they should not be overly worried about?
Sorry, could you repeat the question again?
So yes, it's really looking at the difference between the specialist service we have here,
yes,
and the complications women suffered with mesh. But when people hear the word mesh, they think it applies to absolutely all mesh, and they think it applies to all different types of surgery. So I'm looking for some for your opinion as to whether we can reassure women that mesh in other circumstances is very different and safe.
Yes. I can only comment on mesh used for gynecological procedures because as a gynecologist, I'm unable to comment on the use of mesh for hernia surgery, for example. I'm aware that there is a petition in front of the petition committee with regards to mesh devices in other areas. I'm unable to reassure or not reassure women about these issues. But since September 2018, since the health minister at the time confidently suspended the mesh procedures, no mesh procedure have been implanted vaginally. However, there are abdominal mesh procedures are being performed for gynecological surgery, and the risks are different. The risks are perceived as to be less. However, we have gone so far in providing the information and the offering the alternatives to abdominal mesh surgery for prolapse. So while I have my own views on this, but the standard in Scotland now is that mesh for gynecology can only be implanted abdominally after full informed consent and after the patient has fully understood the alternative. And this is a significant improvement since the height of the crisis about 9 years ago.
I think Mr. O'Kelly wanted to come in.
Back to the mesh centres in England. We have worked closely with the developments of the centres in England. It should be recognised that the centre in Scotland was established almost a year prior to publication of the Cumberland report. We recognised the need for this, so we were forerunners. I think colleagues in Glasgow are to be congratulated for the work they've done and now for the evidence they have from patient engagement, public involvement and the improvement in performance that they are registering. Anna, I think is the comments that she makes about the Glasgow Centre being a leader, I think that's right. In a number of fields, full mesh removal surgery, in taking forward a credential, etc. I think colleagues are to be congratulated for that. And it should also just be pointed out that they have achieved all this at a time of intense scrutiny, both in the media and in Parliament. I think that has been very difficult for them. So I think we should recognise that. With regard to mesh and other sites, I think your colleague on the committee, I think you spoke at the and I may correct me if I'm wrong, there was a debate in Parliament about mesh used in other sites, particularly in hernia repair. And I think this is an issue that has been considered at length. The Scottish Health Technologies Group undertook two reviews, one into inguinal hernia repair, predominantly in men, because that's men are affected, but also subsequently in hernia sites elsewhere and involving more women. I think the conclusion is that in hernia repair, mesh should be used, although alternatives should be available, and the use in mesh in other sites is supported. It should be supported. And we know from the longevity that mesh has been inserted for hernia repair that there aren't the same issues in the same volume of issues that we're seeing with women. So going back to Dr. Aguirre's comment about transvaginal mesh, yes, there is a halt and there's no prospect that will be removed, and the Cabinet Secretary has reiterated that point. With regard to the use in gynaecology of mesh through the pelvic or abdominal routes, these are the subject of a high vigilance protocol. The accountable officers and Alan Mathers is one of those responsible for ensuring that there's attention to detail with dotting of I's, crossing of T's to make sure patients understand, et cetera, et cetera. So this can only be used where there really aren't reasonable alternatives, and recognise that, but also where there's a high degree of scrutiny to ensure that patients completely understand what is going to happen, why it is happening, and that they have had the information and are empowered to make decisions for themselves.
Thank you. Colin Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My question is to Terry O'Neill. Mr. O'Neill, there should be scrutiny, and it is more than just dotting I's and crossing T's. What I read in the papers for this meeting was harrowing. What has happened to many of these women is harrowing. So has the service for women in Scotland been set up in line with the NHS England service specification? And if not, why not?
It's Terry O'Kelly rather than Terry O'Neill, but as it said, it's simple. I think that the commissioning of services in England, as you know, is different. And certainly in England, there have been a number of commissioned specialist services for women who suffer from stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse. And I think the number is 40. And within that, there are 9 centres which have applied for and been designated as mesh removal or mesh. It could manage mesh removal surgery should that be required. So the commissioning is different and the payments are different. As you know, it's commissioned through health boards here in Scotland. Each health board in Scotland has an accountable officer, and we've been meeting with accountable officers since 2018-2019. They are responsible, they are either medical directors or very senior medical managers like Alan Mathers, who are responsible for ensuring that women, the care for women, goes forward in a way which they need and is commensurate with their problems. I am absolutely not complacent about the management of these women. In fact, I'm probably the sort of Raab-esque end of the spectrum of engagement and demand. The stories that women tell. Are absolutely harrowing, and I have great sympathy with what has happened to them. But we do need to move forward, and we need to ensure that the services that we provide for women, the way we communicate with them, are at a level where not only do they feel supported, that they are empowered to make decisions, but when that about the treatment, when that treatment goes forward, it is provided at the highest possible level. And we have worked very hard with the boards, with clinicians, to ensure that is the case. And I am sorry, I was very concerned to read the Spice report, very troubled by it. It's not clear whether all the comments that are made are contemporary, and it would be helpful, I think, to spend some time with and just look at that. I would draw your attention to the work that's been done and is ongoing in Glasgow with the patient engagement and public involvement team. And I think that, you know, they are addressing those issues. And it does appear, given the satisfaction that patients are reporting, that a lot of what has gone on before has been addressed and has been corrected. So I hope that answers your question.
Would you like to come back in, Tess?
Not really, Mr. O'Kelly. If you could actually say what has been set up in line with NHS England, if not, why not? If you'd answer that question, I'd agree.
So what are you talking about? People with mesh complications, or the treatment of patients, the care for patients with? Presented with stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse?
The latter, thank you.
So we have worked with the health boards, with accountable officers, that we have looked at provision of services for those patients. I think this is work that is ongoing, but I have no reason to suspect that what we're asking of boards and what they're delivering is really any less than is being delivered in NHS England. And certainly, I've been part of a pelvic floor oversight group looking.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move to
Carol Mockin to lead us on options for non-surgical treatment. Thank you.
Thank you. I think today has really raised for me the sort of importance of this non-surgical side, and I'm sure for other members as well. So I really appreciate you speaking about that, and a lot of the issues have been covered as you've gone through the session. I wonder if there's anything in terms of communication with the boards that we need to do around that, and also specifically whether you think there should be an expansion around the multidisciplinary team and any pain management, because there's a lot of work in pain management out in the community and with other services that provide that, and whether that would be helpful for women who can't or choose not to go down the surgical route.
Thank you. So I'd hope you'd recognise, and I think you have from what I've been saying, that we really value that non-surgical approach and the elements of that, the pain management, the psychological support, but also the explanation and understanding about what's happened to them. Sometimes, and the survey reflects, you know, the difficulty with communication and understanding what has actually happened. And we see women that have had multiple surgeries, multiple partial removals, and the questions asked about, you know, what's happened to them, what's left. And so a significant part of this is about re-establishing trust. And I think that's reflected by the fact we're having these committees and these meetings. A lot of this is about establishing that trust relationship with women again, and them understanding really what the mesh was in there for the first place. Why was it put in? What was it? What were we trying to do? Because actually no one put this mesh in with the intent to harm. You know, no doctor would have done that. Everything that was done was with the true belief that this was going to help the women. And it is a sad reflection, and it was in the Cumberledge report about the harm that's happened from that. We can't undo those harms, but what we can do is try and do the best that we can for these women. And the GGNC Centre has some state-of-the-art scanners that it can actually see in a different way from the scanners that perhaps other specialist services have, exactly what's there and what can be done there. And there's also that skill about interpreting that information and being able to convey that information. And a lot of the feedback that the GGNC service have had is around actually the number of multidisciplinary team members. So in fact, one of the responses to the survey work they've done is to make it so that not everybody in that multidisciplinary team is there in every room, because I think it could be a bit overwhelming in that. So it's one of the big changes that actually they've made is about how that information is delivered in a steady way, and that may need to come back and have that information repeated. Pain control, psychological support, we've spoken about that as well, and certainly there is dedicated pharmacy support within the GGNC team as well around that.
Can I just want to add a point to this, is the issues of improving confidence in the women in the service. Obviously, there are historic issues with this, and we fully understand why many of these women have describe communication issues and describe empathy issues and lack of trust, et cetera, et cetera. And one way of improving this is by reassuring them that we are communicating within ourselves, within the multidisciplinary team well. We know everything about them, and we are communicating this from the local hospital to the national center well. And that is easy when we talk about surgical issues. So it's very easy to communicate that this surgery has been done locally and the patient wants to have this surgery done nationally or outside Scotland. What is difficult is the non-surgical treatment. So when the patient is referred from locally to nationally, the national center does not know exactly what sort of non-surgical treatment happened locally. And one of the reasons behind this is that we don't communicate to the national center. We could say, yeah, the patient has been referred to the psychologist, but what has actually happened? What was the response to the patient to that? The patient has been referred to the physiotherapist. Has actually improved? Well, probably she didn't, because she requires the referral to the national center in the first place. But what I'm proposing here is that we have a multidisciplinary team discussion, the local clinician, and the team nationally, and we talk about those patients. What did we do exactly? There are things that I can communicate to a clinician colleague that the electronic form will not communicate. And we used to have that, and that is in the paper that I circulated to the committee a few days ago. That it's a historic paper, it describes practice that's probably a decade ago, but it does show that when we talk to each other, when we are present in the same room, either virtually or whatever, and most of these meetings were done virtually, by the way, before COVID, a few years before COVID, we were able to communicate well, and we did have the trust of the women, because the woman, oh, you've spoken to this person that I'm going to see in Glasgow. Yes, I did. And I think that is a good point. And it will also reduce the waiting time, because I can see in the patient leaflet provided by National Service Scotland is that there are two steps in the pathway here that could be replaced by an in-person meeting, a virtual meeting, or simply you would invite the local clinician who referred from the local hospital to the National Centre to attend this particular part of the mesh MDT nationally that discusses their own patients. So they go there and I would be able to present my own patient to the team, tell the team exactly what sort of treatment she had locally and what her wishes are. And I think that this interface between the secondary care and the National Centre would boost the patient confidence, and hopefully that would be reflected in the next survey.
Very helpful, thank you.
Okay, Emma Harper.
I'm interested in just going right back to the beginning, knowing what we know now about mesh complications implanted for stress urinary incontinence, right? So as a nurse who worked in the operating theatre, I participated in anterior and posterior pelvic floor repair operations. But before we even go there, is there work being done to encourage, whether it's continence nurses, physios, midwives, to talk about things like pelvic floor exercise it's free, it's free advice. Is that something where we're measuring whether that work is going ahead, which actually might mitigate the need for any surgical intervention in the first place?
Yes, so that engagement with non-surgical treatment for conditions that are induced by childbirth injuries, in terms of incontinence and prolapse, the first non-surgical options are the physiotherapy and the continence advice. Physiotherapists and continence nurses are integral part of MDTs in I think almost every health board, and they are the intervention they perform has prevented many women from having surgery. So it is those women where these interventions don't work, then they would get discussed by the MDT, which include myself and other surgeons and gynecologists, to discuss the surgical option. But yes, it is there. I'm not sure whether anything at a government level, maybe Terry would be able to help with that, whether this is being done on a larger scale, for example, to schools, if we talk about pelvic floor education for girls at school, even before the reproductive period, that would certainly, if we start this seed at the very beginning, that would be important.
Just and at schools, for instance, one of my former colleagues teaches Pilates, but she also does pelvic floor exercises as part of that to kind of destigmatize it as well. But she's even seeing young women in schools that like breaking down these barriers of conversation. So is that work that you would support, is like take it right out to the schools, take it to the level before young women start I suppose experiences that might lead to urinary incontinence?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, there's no doubt about it. Many women who after childbirth and they come with already damage that has caused incontinence and prolapse. These are the problems that we're talking about, and they were the reason why the mesh was introduced in the first place. When they come in, many of them don't even know what the pelvic floor is and how to contract the pelvic floor, how to engage the pelvic floor, and that's why the physiotherapists spend quite a lot of time with them, educating them. But if this happens from school at the very beginning, then during the reproductive career, at the end of this, if they were unlucky to develop these conditions, then at least they will be able to know what's going on and will be able perhaps to engage better with the physiotherapy service. The other point of improvement would also be postpartum physiotherapy, which would immediately after delivery. The program at the moment, it's my understanding that it is relatively short period of time, and there is a possibility of improving this program to extend it at a lengthy or to a more regular supervised sessions by the physiotherapist for prevention in the future. And we're talking about just in the very first few weeks after delivery.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Torrens, you wanted to cover some points on local and national services.
Thank you very much, Convener. Around what are the benefits of a national service over a local one in supporting women affected by transvaginal mesh? I'll come to Dr. Lamont, please.
Sorry, could you rephrase the question?
What's the benefits of a national service over local services?
Thank you. So, nationally commissioned services are highly specialist services. They're services that it would not be possible to provide in 14 different territorial health boards. I mean, that's reflected in that there are 9 specialist centres being provided across the entirety of England and, you know, 1 for Scotland. NSD, as part of NSS, commissions approximately 150 highly specialist services for Scotland. These are services that are funded through the individual boards, but they all contribute to that national service. And they all reflect whereby there needs to be a highly specialised service that then can provide competence and confidence in a national service. We would not be able to be having these conversations about the confidence and trust if these services were being tried to be provided from multiple centres that would then only be seeing a few small numbers of cases. So primarily national services are about whereby you would need to concentrate that expertise, both actually to attract people into those services, to be able to provide that as a national service, but also to convey confidence and competence to those people that are then actually utilising those services.
In the current financial circumstances, is it feasible for bespoke services to be established in every health board or region?
So I refer back to my previous answer. It would not be possible, nor would it be desirable, to try and establish a bespoke service in every single centre. You would not be able to provide that level of number of cases and experience and expertise and confidence if every single centre was trying to provide the same sort of service. We also have to recognise value to the NHS here and value to the women that are undertaking these services, you know, accessing these services. You know, we need to provide highly effective and efficient services. That's part of our responsibility as, you know, the NHS. And providing these services, which are highly specialised, highly competent in individual centres, is a mechanism to achieve that. We would love to be able to provide, of course, highly specialised services that are accessible short distances from home for everybody. But when we are dealing with specialised services, the demographics and geography of Scotland does not provide for us to be able to provide highly specialised services in every centre of Scotland. And that's a reality that we all face when we're looking at trying to arrange services.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just make a point on that in the petitions committee, which I was formerly a member of, we did hear evidence from Dr. Neto from the Shoulders Hospital in Ontario in Canada, and he made a similar point about the need for centralised services to provide that sufficient scale of experience, critical mass of expertise. I just wondered if you have undertaken any international benchmarking about service design and considering how to develop this in Scotland.
So the service agreement that we have as national services are under continual review, and we have a regular cycle of review. As has already been mentioned by Dr. Kelly, this service in Glasgow was actually the first service in the UK to be set up. So I think reflecting on what we were talking about, Hurst England, you know, are we following England? Well, in fact, in many respects, what has been done in England is following what's happened in Scotland. We're at a very early stage in terms of that idea of benchmarking. There are the national committees, which has already been mentioned. And I think primarily the mechanism towards that is around credentialing. And that's the route that we're all going down. It's going to take time because it's not something that's been done specifically within Scotland, but there is a commitment from the team within GGNC to that, and they've already progressed and applied for that. And there is an expectation that all those within GGNC will then qualify for that.
Thank you. I think Mr. Kelly wanted to make a point.
Yeah, it's just to say that, and I recognise the point about shoulders, but when the centre was established, it was the recommendations for establishing the centre was the work or the outcome of short life working groups. Look at this, engaged with all necessary stakeholders, health boards, patient groups, and other clinical groups. And the decision was to support development, continued development of the specialist service in Glasgow. And this, as noted, came a year before conclusions in the IMDS report. Anna's mentioned credentialing. I think it's going to be really important to benchmark clinicians in Scotland against a curriculum and framework which has been published by the College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists, working with the College of Surgeons in England, with the specialist associations, but also with patient reference group. The documents have been out for wide consultation, including public review. So I'd encourage people to look at that. The other thing we will be introducing soon is a registry, not only to look at patients who are having mesh removal surgery, but also primary surgery for stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse. So all procedures will be captured, and that is a UK-wide registry that will allow us to look at our activity and our outcomes that will include patient-reported outcomes for all these procedures, and will allow benchmarking, comparison, etc. And hopefully will help to further build confidence in the centre in Glasgow, but also in the care for patients across Scotland.
Thank you. Dr. Gurr, did you want to make a point?
No, thank you. Dr. O'Kelly has just made it.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Ms. Harper, do you want to make a supplementary point?
Yep, just a quick point. The convener mentioned the shoulder ice approach, but the strict criteria for a shoulder ice repair, like weight loss, no alcohol, ability to exercise. So it might be difficult to apply that in the sense of Scotland, for instance, when there might be additional comorbidities that people have that do present that might need a inguinal hernia repair using mesh, for instance. Is that something that we can't compare apples with oranges?
Again, this is outside my expertise because I'm not a general surgeon. I've done only two hernia repairs in my whole life, and that was before I specialised as a gynaecologist, but I'm not qualified enough to give you a full answer to that. However, in general, the shoulder ice repair is a non-mesh repair that in shoulder ice hospital has wonderful outcome. And they managed to save the vast majority of their patients having to have a permanent mesh device implanted forever that can cause problems in the future. Clearly, it's the mesh-related complication induced by hernia mesh appears to be less than that of gynecological for gynecological reasons. There are so many reasons for this. However, the presence of comorbidity, or if we're comparing populations in Scotland, Canada, I don't believe that the presence or any perception of difference in comorbidities should stop a shoulder ice-like approach here in Scotland. At least you start building the native tissue approach, and at least you try to you allow the surgical technique to evolve, our surgeons to improve their skills and be more confident in offering the native tissue non-mesh surgery. There needs to be clinically based criteria, selection criteria which patients would benefit best from the shoulder ice repair. And this evolution, in my view, needs to start as soon as possible. And these are clinical decisions on individual clinical patients, giving consideration to the comorbidity, definitely. And I do believe that needs to be supported by local government and nationally too. That's my view, but again, I am not an expert in this area, but this is how I see things. I had a hernia repair myself, and it was a shoulder ice repair, and the two hernia repairs I've done were also shoulder ice repairs. So.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Is there any final burning points that any of the panellists would wish to make before we conclude matters? Mr. Kelly?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure this is the environment for discussions about shoulder ice, and that's been well rehearsed previously. One thing I think we haven't mentioned is the patients waiting, and the patients waiting in Scotland, United Kingdom, is a major issue. And I think one of the things we haven't touched on is the possibility of waiting well, programs like Waiting Well, also fit for surgery. I'm also part of the waiting list team here in Scottish Government, and I would advertise and promote these initiatives. There are opportunities for patients to make lifestyle changes in the time that they are coming to surgery to get fit, and I think the long-term health benefits can be very substantial. Certainly evidence from around the country would suggest that. So I think that colleagues in Glasgow will know about these programmes, but it probably is something that we should also consider and promote.
Okay, thank you very much. Just like to thank all of our panellists for your attention and your expertise and your contributions today. We hugely value it as parliamentarians, so just to show our appreciation. So thank you very much, and good afternoon. Okay. We're now going to move into private session to take the next items of business. Thank you.